Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's second meeting of 2022. I've received no apologies from any members for this morning's meeting. First item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? Agreed. Thank you. And the second item today is 2 evidence sessions as part of our short inquiry into health and wellbeing of children and young people. The first session will focus on mental health and child and adolescent mental health services. And we have our panel today. I'll run through everyone who's joining us on our panel. Welcome to the committee, Shelley Buckley, Programme Manager for Families, Children and Young People, the Mental Health Foundation. Alex Cumming, the Assistant Director of Delivery and Development of the Scottish Association for Mental Health. Susie Fitton, the Policy Manager for Inclusion Scotland. Sam March, Principal Educational Psychologist for South Lanarkshire Council, and also representing the Association of Scottish Principal Educational Psychologists. Joanne Smith, Policy and Public Affairs Manager for NSPCC Scotland. And Dr. Mary Stark, Scottish Officer for the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health. Now, a little bit of housekeeping before we start. The clerks have allocated one member of the committee to lead questioning at each of our 8 main themes that we've divided this session into. If any other member wishes to ask a supplementary question on a theme, then use the chat box, put an R in it. If time allows, I will bring you in for a supplementary question. Panelists, obviously we've got 6 of you this morning, so we will try as much as possible to bring all of you in when we can, but obviously with 8 themes and possible supplementary questions, we might not be able to go around all 6 of you for every single. So what we'll do is the members will always direct a question initially, and then if you want to contribute, if you could again use the chat box and put an R in the chat box. And then I'll make sure that I come to you, and we will prioritise your contributions rather than us having lots of supplementary questions. If you get my meaning, you're our experts. We want to hear from you. So I'm going to kick things off, and contradicting myself straight away, I'm actually going around every panel member just so that we get everyone to give their initial thoughts. Programme for Government. Had a lot of commitments around child and adolescent mental health, and in particular getting more support in community settings. A couple of pledges that I've got noted down here about committed to every GP practice having access to mental health and wellbeing services, and more 1,000 more additional dedicated staff members. I mean, we've been hearing for years now that mental health services need to be in communities. We also know that there's a previous pledge about having like school counsellors in place, but obviously pandemic seems to have had an impact on just the deployment of that local authority level. There's lots of interventions coming down the line. There's lots of interventions and there's lots of pledges been made. Can I get each of your assessment about what needs to happen in that community service, and what variations you're seeing around Scotland about the deployment of previous interventions? So if I go to Alex Cumming first of all, and I'll go around every panel member for this.
Morning all, thanks convener. So briefly, yeah, you're right. There are some really exciting building blocks, I would say, and previous pledges, as you've talked about, around child and adolescent mental health services. I think at SAMH we've been certainly advocating and looking for further commitments around the community-based services, children and young people, and those they work with that we're speaking to are absolutely crystal clear that you know, there is clearly a lack of services without community base, particularly under the CAMHS threshold. So the kind of 30 million that the government pledged for community mental health services, I think is really positive, should be commended. But the vast, or from what we can see, certainly a large number of those services are still very much in the implementation phase. So therefore, you know, we don't know the impact yet. I think it's positive, and there will be positive impact there, but we don't know what that looks like yet. And I think the big thing for us, or big thing for me certainly, is I suppose how those services are, how we're marketing and communicating about those services, particularly to the new colleagues within primary care that you've mentioned as well. Because again, if all these things are not connected, then we're not going to make best use of these resources.
Thank you very much for that. And can I come to Shelley Buckley?
I work for the Mental Health Foundation, so much of the focus of our work is very much on promotion and prevention. And I think ultimately, if we continue down the route where we are, I suppose, in this model where we're constantly treating, I suppose, the problem, as opposed to trying to look at ways that we can reinforce the protective factors, or the factors that we know protect communities and families well in the first place, I think there's something about needing to rebalance and reshift some of the resources into that sphere. And what I mean by that is thinking about how we, I suppose, enhance and promote that whole school approach. You know, we've talked about counsellors, but it's also a bit more than that. It's about how we can promote healthy behaviours in families, young people and communities early on that promote good mental health and support, I suppose, positive strategies for stress management. That includes looking at how we can connect, I suppose, those kind of services such as your kind of your school nurses, thinking about community-based organisations and how they can link more meaningfully into those schools and communities and understand better what the needs of those communities are. And also, again, thinking on those kind of skills building, I think there's something about supporting universal services and all community-based services on those and building those skills around those health-promoting strategies and techniques that you can utilise, and enabling, I suppose, those services to work together and to connect more closely into statutory services and think more holistically about how we can bolster the skills of those staff. I think the big thing is about taking the pressure off statutory services. At the minute, we've got a real bottleneck into crisis services where we're having to almost upskill or we're having to like up threshold, I suppose, and up tariff families in order to get a service. And that's a really big problem. So things like, for example, young people waiting for assessment because of neurodiversity. I'm doing some work at the moment where we're doing a little bit of research and looking around CAMHS over in Dundee. And you know what we've identified actually is kind of eight key areas where families are really kind of straightforward kind of approaches that we could do with community-based services. So it's about shifting, I suppose, the skills from CAMHS, those experts, and kind of asking them to kind of support those community-based organisations with really simple tasks like, you know, managing sleep, positive parenting practices, you know, helping families communicate better with schools about what the learning and development needs are of their child. Parents, the feedback overwhelmingly has been that parents don't want their child necessarily to have a label or to have medication. What they want is that holistic support and advice, something that they can engage with and feel in control of, instead of having to wait very, very long periods of time for that type of support. So there are some really simple strategies that we can do in targeted ways as well to support families, communities, and also strengthen those protective factors by utilising the skills of those specialist services to build capacity within the community-based organisations. I think that relationship and the empowerment of that relationship is going to be really important. There's also the issue of kind of changing our narrative around this, because there's still such a lot of stigma and shame. And in order to address some of these problems earlier on, we still need to support families, support communities to be able to articulate what the challenges are. And we know that poverty and inequality and the cumulative impact of that is some of the biggest factors that kind of contribute to poor mental health in our communities. And that in itself is a really big thing for families to be able to articulate and address. And although we welcome, you know, the Scottish Government's strategies around free bus passes, for example, for under 22s to enable them to kind of move more freely and access things more freely in their community and opportunities for them, which we think is, you know, that social interaction is really important. But it's making access to these things much, much easier. It's making sure that it's there aren't those practical barriers to that can cause it, that can be quite difficult. I mean, so I'm only after just doing the bus pass for my family, and what I noticed was there's quite a lot of layers of bureaucracy and quite a lot of challenge for families, I think, who don't necessarily have the resource, the technology to access, I suppose, that universal benefit, that universal opportunity. And I think there's something about, as well as looking at, although the policy is good, how does it work on the ground? Are we further excluding people?
Thank you. And that was a point that I had a topical question on that very thing last week, where I made those points. So thanks for that, Shelley. And can I come to Susie Fitton?
Yes, thank you. Disabled children and young people are more likely to experience social deprivation, social isolation and digital exclusion, and to have poor mental health as a result. And children and adolescents with learning disability, for example, are over 6 times more likely to have a diagnosable mental illness or psychiatric disorder than children who don't have a learning disability. And therefore, timely access to child and adolescent mental health services is extremely important for disabled children and young people. Our research during the 2 lockdown periods and research from other disabled people's organisations has shown that disabled children, young people and their families have experienced what we can only really describe as a mental health crisis during the pandemic. And they've been harder hit by COVID-19, not only because they may be at greater risk of the virus and of severe illness, but equally or more so because the pandemic has supercharged the existing inequality that they already face, and it has made new inequality likely. So we find that child and adolescent mental health for disabled children is being compromised by factors such as strained family relationships, digital exclusion, academic stress at school, and loneliness, and reduced social contact with friends. And this has all been magnified with the reduced access to routine mental health support, including camp supervision, care and rehabilitation services, so lack of access to those services that would actually take the pressure off families of disabled children, disruption to routine that everybody has experienced during the pandemic, but has been particularly pronounced for disabled children, particularly those children who don't understand why their lives have changed so much and why there has been so much disruption to routine. We've seen much more pronounced social isolation, and in some cases there has been poorly tailored public health messaging and a lack of emergency preparedness. And I'll be talking about the removal and the reduction of social care during the lockdown periods for families of disabled children. So reduction of social care for disabled children, but also for disabled parents. And that has created an inordinate amount of stress and anxiety that has only kind of exacerbated disabled children's mental health issues. So obviously we have seen very positive pledges around CAMHS, further commitments for community services that has already been discussed, and the $30 million for community mental health services. I think there will be positive impact from those things. I think there have been some very strong commitments from the Scottish Government to supporting CAMHS. But as the last speaker said, the mental health issues that disabled children and young people face often relate directly to social deprivation and the link between disability and poverty. Disabled parents and disabled children and young people are much more likely to be living in poverty in Scotland, and we really need to address the poverty experienced by children in families that experience disability, and I'll be making further reference to some of the ways that we can do that in this session.
Thank you very much, Susie. And with regard to the COVID-19, additional pressures, one of my colleagues will be looking into that directly later on in the session. Can I come now to Sam March?
Thank you, convener. I think some the point about connection that Alec made is a really good one. We really need to work on our connections, our single point of access. One of the things I think we need to do is avoid, I call them pinball type referrals, where young people sort of bounce through the system. Also, Shelley's point about whole school approaches is fundamental, and that's whole school approaches, a preventative approach, is a really, really key thing. Last summer, we launched, as PET were part of that, there was a Scottish Government whole school approaches document and framework, which should be a good building block for prevention within schools over the next few years. But it's a challenging time to do that, and it is a challenging time to connect all of the dots in terms of the system, so we need to get it right. As PEP and educational psychologists are involved in implementation of counselling and community mental health interventions, counselling is probably a bit further on, and counselling is seen as an early intervention resource, but it's probably having to pick up a bit more across the country. It's probably having to pick up a bit more acute needs following COVID. But it is getting fairly well embedded in schools. Some young people want to work with those that they already know and have relationships with. So counselling is part of the solution. Community mental health, there are good things coming from that as well, I think, and good use of the third sector, but it is quite early in terms of its implementation. And local authority partners are really excited about working with the third sector and some of the things that are already happening and already involved. When we are getting it right, I think in particular, we're kind of having really good single point of access to make sure, as I say, that families get that early intervention. And we really need to think creatively about routes that have been, for instance, the GP route to CALMS, et cetera, and alternative loops that come back and are able to provide earlier support. One of the interventions in South Lanarkshire that's been trialled is DBI, and I believe that's from a separate budget funding, but it's a really promising intervention, and it's got a loop back into CALMS, and it's also responsive and early intervention and easy to access as well. So there is a lot that's going on as well. But it's actual connecting some of these things as well, and it's a hard time to do whole system implementation of this. And my concern would be that the early intervention side of it through counselling and community, is that funding dwarfed by the funding that specialist services get as well. And going forward, I think it's right to be cautious about community mental health in some ways, because it's a hard thing to, it's a new service, and it's hard to get right. But as you say, convener, that is where we want to provide the support that's really accessible. That's for families and for children and young people.
Thank you. And can I come to Joanne Smith?
Thanks, convener, and thank you for the opportunity to provide further evidence today. I think I would agree with Shelley's point about the need to balance the kind of urgent crisis with more kind of longer term strategic service planning. We know that the government's commitments around community mental health services and support were introduced in January of 2021. So it would be really helpful, I think, for the committee to be asking questions of the government about what we're learning from the robust multi-agency monitoring processes that accompanied the establishment of those services. So what do we know 1 year on about the readiness of local areas to implement a community mental health approach? And can we be confident that our children and young people are now receiving timely assessment and appropriate referral? Now, our learning from Childline data through the pandemic would suggest that we're not getting it right, unsurprisingly, given the kind of pressures on the system. But we know that children are contacting our counsellors, sharing their distress about the inability to access support, about the long gaps between any support that is available, about the disillusion that comes with a kind of decision that their criteria isn't sufficient to warrant support. So it sends a strong message to children about how we value their wellbeing. So there's much to be done. And I think in terms of your question around just what do we know about what's happening around the country, I mean, the other speaker just mentioned that CAMHS is, of course, one element of a system of support around children and families. And we know that that wider support system has been undermined by cuts to local authority budgets. NSPCC's carried out research by Susan Galloway, which looked at the availability of family support provision in Scotland initially in 2013 and then revisited it in 2020. And what was seen was a decline in the availability of that family support, both within the third sector and within statutory services. So, of course, these pressures on our wider systems will undermine any attempt at creating a community mental health offer for children and families. But I think a critical first step is understanding what capacity exists locally within our systems. So, mapping our capacity, not within single disciplines, as is happening in some areas, but actually across disciplines. What is the strengths and weaknesses within our local systems? And so that we can ensure that the investment that has been made available is targeted accordingly to make sure that we can deliver the best outcomes for children and babies and families.
Thank you very much, Joanne. And finally, can I come to Dr. Mary Stark?
Thank you, Convener, for giving me this opportunity to discuss some of these issues that we're seeing increasingly in paediatrics. I'm Scottish Officer for the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, and I'm also a general paediatrician at the new Children's Hospital in Edinburgh. And I was reflecting yesterday that I think I'm a paediatrician, but I also seem to be becoming a child psychiatrist. A huge amount of my work is now child psychiatry, and it's very difficult to get expert help for these children, and there's definitely children out there in crisis. Mental health has a lot of different issues. It includes anxiety, chronic fatigue, anorexia, and neurodevelopmental conditions like ASD. And we're seeing increasing numbers of children coming to clinic with physical issues because of their underlying mental health issues that have not been met, which can be not met for years. And these children are not in school a lot of the time. And it can take, we know that I have children that I'm going to refer to for ASD assessments or mental health assessments, and they're going to have to wait 10 months to 2 years for that assessment. So that may be 2 years further out of school when they're 12, 13. That's their lifelong education. That's their career opportunities. That's their health as adults. We do know that 50% of adults with mental health problems had their difficulties before the age of 14. So we're not looking just at children's difficulties, we're looking at adult difficulties further down the line. And it's really important that we take that on board and start prioritising children. The COVID pandemic has severely affected children. They haven't been dying in ITU, but their life chances are significantly reduced because we're taking services away from them. And we really need to be building services up for young people. Waiting times for both our CAMHS referrals and for general paediatrics, which is full of children with mental health problems that are now, it's easier to get into general paediatrics. So we're seeing in that area and doing our best to try and improve the life for young people. They're just getting longer and longer. It's months and months. And then we have people in our acute wards that we can't get into acute. So if you have anorexia, you'll come to the general paediatric ward. And at the moment, we haven't, certainly over the weekend, we had no young people mental health beds in Scotland available. This is across Scotland. It's difficult. We don't want to send children to England for community services. It should be done here. We need to increase all services. We need data on the prevalence of mental health conditions in Scotland. How many children have got anxiety? How many children are waiting? And how many people are seeing their GPs and their parents have been sent away saying, well, there's no point in doing a CAMHS referral because they'll just get bounced back. So there's so many children out there that aren't even getting referred because it takes a lot of time to do these referrals because they know they're not going to get seen. So how are we going to sort this? We're going to have to do a lot of different things. I think the community interventions and actually basic community interventions, things, the poverty issue. If you're in poverty, you can't afford good food and you can't afford to go to groups, you can't afford to do exercise opportunities. Young children tell us that poverty stops you feeling healthy, happy and well. This is underlying pinning of all these things. So if children are not getting help when they're toddlers, in my clinic, I can identify two-year-olds who I know will have mental health difficulties when they're 12, 13, 14. We need to be intervening really early. We need to be looking at ways to try and improve children's health right at the beginning and giving all children opportunities to do exercise, have healthy diets and things that we know are the building blocks for good mental health. We need to be having neurodevelopmental services. I'm finding increasing numbers of children coming to my paediatric clinic who are maybe 12 or 13 who've got underlying ASD that's never been diagnosed. And it takes 2 to 3 years to get ASD assessments and then to get your interventions. And then you'll be into adult services. We need to get school counsellors. We need to get supports in place for these children. And there's a whole group of children, the children that are in second year at school, they've missed their P7 residentials. They've missed their S1 residentials. That may be the only time that child has had an opportunity to go away from the family home, make team building with their friends, do activities. That's gone. And there's no plans for a kind of catch up of opportunities. It's just, oh, well, you missed that, tough luck. These children feel that they're not being prioritised by government. Businesses, you know, great. Adults will get to go to restaurants and nightclubs. But what about all the community groups that need funding? Some of these are quite cheap to run, but they're not getting the funding. The third sectors have to go for funding every few months. They spend half their time not looking after the children, but trying to get funding. And youth work organisations, we need to have more youth work. We've now got youth navigators on our paediatric ward to try and support some of these families who are in crisis, because we know we need to do something. But that funding isn't necessarily going to continue. We need to keep going for funding. We need to get the building blocks. You know, we can't necessarily magic up lots of paediatric psychiatrists. We can't even magic up lots of paediatricians. But we do need, we know we can get more community services across the board. We need to be really helping these young people.
Okay, thank you. So we've heard a lot of things which my colleagues are going to specifically dig into. We won't have the opportunity for every member to have all six panelists because we just don't have the time. I wish we did, because there's a lot in there. So we're going to hand over now in terms of accessing specialist support to my colleague Sue Weber. Sue.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose we've heard at length there that there's actually a challenge accessing services to the scale of the issue and the challenges that our young people are facing. And we've certainly received evidence that referrals continue to rise year on year, and that resonates with what you've said this morning. But why do you think that more children and young people are requiring specialist services for their mental health? We've just heard about Dr. Stark intimating poverty being one of the key factors, but is there anything else that you think might be driving that at the moment?
And can you direct your question, please, Sue?
Dr. Stark first, as I referenced her previous statement.
I think there's always been mental health issues, but I think COVID has been very difficult because some children were having difficulties and anxiety issues, and we took them out of school. We put them onto virtual learning. They were told that, oh, stay in your bedrooms and go on a computer all day. And the children that were very anxious are now kind of like, well, I've lost that ability to go out and meet people and do things. Some children are desperate to get out and meet people and go on the bus and socialise. Some people have lost those skills and are becoming increasingly anxious. And it's very difficult for children to gain that confidence. A lot of the opportunities they might have had before just aren't there. So if you're not doing things, you lose that ability. You lose confidence. We all lose confidence. That will not be helping. I think that there's a lot of children with chronic fatigue. We have no chronic fatigue services in Scotland. I was hoping that the long COVID money would, some of that could be directed to long COVID services. But so many of the money and things available are all to adults. You know, the children are the ones that are missing out. And it's very difficult for families to support young people because they don't have the tools.
Can I bring in Susie Fitton, who would like to come in on that question? Susie?
Yes, just to back up what Dr. Stark is saying, we did some research in lockdown to find out what the impact that the pandemic was having on disabled people across Scotland, so both adults and children. And it was very clear from an analysis of the responses that risk from COVID-19 for disabled children and young people was about much more than simply a risk to health. So we found that stress, fear and anxiety and sleep disturbance were pervasive for disabled children and young people who were shielding or those who were self-isolating, and disabled children and young people who were trying to follow social distancing measures. And it was really very significant for disabled children and young people with pre-existing mental health conditions that were made worse by social isolation and anxiety about the future. Disabled children and young people at high risk of the virus who were shielding, but who actually lived with key workers and were therefore at risk of the virus, were under particular strain. Disabled children and young people who had limited social networks or who found digital or remote communication difficult or impossible. So digital exclusion has been pervasive, actually, for many disabled children and young people, and has only exacerbated poor mental health. That disabled children and young and adult children who struggled to understand and follow social distancing rules were in very kind of anxious and stressful situations. And disabled children and young people who were shielding but who relied on external carers or family members for personal care. So what we had was some really, really, really difficult situations for families of disabled children. Some disabled children went from having 2-to-1 support in residential accommodation to being sent home to parents trying to juggle childcare of other children with home working and getting no statutory support to care for disabled children. Some parents told us that their children were exhibiting behaviours such as self-harm, vocal tics, very low mood and challenging behaviour because of the removal of structure, daily activity, routine, face-to-face contact with friends and access to the outdoors. And just to reiterate some of what Dr. Stark has talked about, in terms of disabled children actually losing their social skills, losing their independent living skills. Many parents talked of their children all of the efforts that had been made by residential schools or by schools in general to support disabled children's social skills. So much of that they saw their children regressing, particularly during lockdown. Now, obviously, our evidence is from the two lockdown periods, and some of the stresses on disabled children will have lessened as some of the restrictions have eased. But I think this evidence is still important because evidence from previous pandemics, such as SARS in 2003, has demonstrated the potential for long-lasting effects on children's mental health. The length of time that children felt lonely predicted mental health problems up to 9 years later, particularly depression. So I think the evidence from lockdown from disabled children is as important now as it was at the time in many ways, because children who experience extreme social isolation are much more likely to require support for mental health services and to experience high levels of post-traumatic stress.
Thank you. And can I come to Sam March?
Thank you. It's a really big question, and I guess there's not one reason. We consulted with young people in during lockdown, and 72% of over 3,000 young people said that the biggest thing for them that affected their mental health was family life, followed by peer relationships. There's a mixed relationship in terms of social media, the school experience as well. If you track back over the last 15-20 years, children are slightly more likely to say that worry about, concern about schoolwork is a factor. So there's a range of factors. There's been loads of work done by on school culture and ethos and promoting positive relationships, and school does buffer in terms of mental health outcomes for many, very many young people. It hasn't fundamentally changed the number of young people that say they don't enjoy school, unfortunately. So there seems to be a range of factors and we did some research during COVID, and for some young people, slowing down and having the avoidance of life stressors was actually something that they were seeking comfort for in early lockdown. And I think, you know, so we need to take a really holistic perspective to understanding exactly, you know, modern life is placing greater stresses on children and young people and families, and, you know, and family stress is part of that as well.
Thank you. Can I come to Shelley Buckley?
I don't want to repeat other things that the speakers have said, but I certainly agree with everything that they have said, and that, you know, COVID has certainly escalated or exacerbated the existing vulnerabilities that we already have in our community. So we know, like the State of a Generation report, which was published just before COVID, I suppose the issues that were highlighted within it, our COVID study kind of just reinforced that. So it's those young people who are experiencing trauma, abuse and neglect, refugees and asylum seeking families, parents who have got comorbidity problems, so looked after children. These are all kind of factors that are influencing children's home life. The point that Sam talks about, you know, the conditions and the family relationships that exist for young people are having a significant impact on their well-being, and also how they develop into adults. One of the other massive issues, however, that has come out of that report is identity. And this whole change in our society, you know, our society is changing. We have this technological and digital revolution. You know, we have a generation of young people growing up, and their perception of the world and the expectations and the roles that they perform within that vastly different from our, certainly my childhood experience. And we're going through this kind of change in society where, in some respects, you know, we are using this adult lens to analyse and assess the needs of our young people and our children, but actually their perspective is skewed because how society functions, how they engage in relationships, how they communicate with each other is extremely different to what our experience would have been. But that, nonetheless, one of the significant issues then that was coming out of that, the State of the Generation report, was, you know, racial and ethnic identity was massively important. Are we speaking the same language, even in the words that we use? Are they understood in the same way when we talk to families about mental health and well-being? Are we taking account of diversity in terms of beliefs and values? Sexual identity and gender identity, massively important. One of the biggest issues, I would say, that schools are dealing with today, in terms of young people trying to figure out who they are, you know, how to form relationships, what healthy sexual relationships look like, intersectional issues then that flow off of that. What the previous speaker, I think it was Susie, was talking about, learning disability and identity has been massive. for such a long time and continues to be so. For all of the reasons that their vulnerabilities have been exacerbated, for all of the reasons that Susie has talked about, identity and school transitions, leaving school, academic pressure and uncertainty, all been escalated because of COVID. And this whole issue around body image and what a successful person looks like, what you have to be, what achievement looks like, that is incredibly influential in terms of social media, the narrative and the images that young people are being exposed to 24 hours a day. You know, there is no respite from that. And obviously thinking then how that links in with bullying. And one of the big things from a survey we did with young people didn't find it all that useful to separate out bullying and cyberbullying. To them, it was bullying. Because their world, there is no kind of separation necessarily between that virtual world and the real world.
Thank you. Sue, I have time for you to follow up with a question, and then I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan. Sue.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, Shelley Buckley stated that we look at everything through an adult lens, and specifically she was talking about the looked after children. So bearing in mind that, I'd like to declare an interest as a corporate parent and a councillor in the City of Edinburgh. But again, we met with a lot of young people last night that were in care or looked after children. And we were talking earlier about that single point of access to services, but many of them struggled because they don't have that parent behind pushing. So what could and should be done to inform children and young people and their parents and carers about the services available to them and to make them easier for them to navigate around? I see Shelley nodding, but can I perhaps ask Sam that question first, given his position with Lanarkshire Council? Thanks.
Really, really good question. And I'm trying to make very clear that children who are care experienced and in our children's houses have access to our counselling service. We have a trauma counselling service as well, and so it's there's a piece of work being done with children's house managers in terms of advocacy and awareness and communication, and I've got a responsibility to make sure, you know, when I look at the service use, that it's reaching the right children and young people and proportionately, and alternatives are provided, and speaking to young people and working out what are the individual barriers for services and why. And I mentioned earlier, not every young person wants to access the counselling within school. Are there alternatives? And trying to be kind of creative around that, but speak to young people in terms of the creation of services. Are they one of the other interventions we've used is a really good third sector intervention called Blues, and that works for a lot of children and young people, and it's earlier intervention and it's kind of group work as well, and young people have rated that really positively, so we're continuing the use of that. So it's a real responsibility to co-produce services, basically, fundamentally. You know, co-production features strongly in all the kind of mental health project board kind of specifications, and we're doing it like never before, because there's no point configuring and planning these services. And there's a great resource from NEST, I think it is, about evidence-based interventions. There is absolutely no point in just plucking one off the shelf and saying that looks great because it worked in Connecticut or something like that. We've got to speak to the young people that are the service users, work out what the barriers are, and we've got, you know, and we're doing work on that in authorities.
Thank you. And Alex Cumming wants to come in. Alex.
Yeah, no, I think Sam's just really made my kind of point I was going to make around co-production being absolutely key, and I'm sure all the contributors around the room would agree with that. I think just building on the question that Sue Webber asked around what else can we do around single point of contact for kind of young people and parents, and I think that co-production also relates to parents as well. You know, again, we want to kind of bring in their thoughts and themes and ideas into this as to what would work. But really just what kind of what Shelley Buckley and Dr. Stark have said around, are these adult services? I mentioned right at the start, or convener, you mentioned the number of additional resources going into primary care and mental health support within GP practices. But again, are they still focused on adults? And I think we are certainly about to pilot in South Edinburgh a CYP link worker. And I know there's a number of other kind of initiatives going on in Glasgow and a number of other local authority or health associate partnership areas that are doing something similar. So is that the place that actually children and young people can go? Will young people actually go and access? Will they feel these services are for them? I think is a big question. And I think that's really important for all of us and for, you know, third sector and for primary care as well, to really kind of promote those services as being accessible to young people. So they recognise that these are places that they can go and be linked in as part of that.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I know what Sue was referring to. I was in the same meeting with young people last night and quite distressed to hear a young person say they couldn't get past a GP receptionist when they were in crisis. So, you know, that your point is well made and certainly resonates with some of the experiences that we heard last night. Can I bring in Stephanie Callahan, who's a question on this theme, and then I'll move on to questions around CAMHS waiting times with Evelyn Tweed. Stephanie.
Thanks very much, convener. Certainly good this morning. Good to see the panel here this morning, and good to hear both Shelley and Joanne talking about neurodiversity and the kind of long wait for kind of, you know, quite basic stuff like issues around sleep, positive parenting, communications with schools, etc. There, and certainly what Joanne was saying as well about, you know, having long gaps and the kind of disillusion that comes along when young people are told that they don't meet the criteria for support is something that certainly chimes with me. So I should say probably here that I'm a parent to neurodiverse children and I'm also a counsellor at South Lanarkshire Council too. So in South Lanarkshire as well, there is the Arch Autism Hub and they do an amazing job actually of really quite groundbreaking work as far as holistic support goes and really integrating council, third sector, health, parents, carers, integrating all those things together there. And one of the top things that you hear the parents ask for is actually advocacy support. So I'm really interested in whether or not panel members think this should be a kind of top priority as far as the Scottish Government go. And I'll maybe direct that to Mary.
Mary, I think the neurodiversity is a big issue. I think we need to be really having much more rapid assessments for young people, for young children, and then school supports. I think the advocacy, people are needing advocates because they're having to fight through a system. But should we not have a system where people don't have to fight through? It should be easier. It's like somebody said earlier about the bus pass. I haven't even. It's not got onto my to-do list to figure out how I know to do the bus pass. All I've heard is it takes a lot of time, it's difficult. Why do we need to make things so difficult? Some families will not be able to advocate for their children. We need to look out for those children. So the schools and anybody that's looking after the children need to be their advocates. But we should just make the system easier for people. It shouldn't have to be a fight. It shouldn't be the case that only if you have a kind of maybe referred to as a stroppy, difficult parent, will you get the help you need? All families, all children should be able to get the help they need without fighting. It should just be there. It's really difficult for all these families. It's really difficult if you have a child that's got neurodiversity. You don't need the system to be difficult. We need to make things as easy for families as possible so we can provide good care at the right time, not with long waits.
Thank you. Can I bring in Shelley Buckley?
I think an interesting project that I've been working around is this whole thing around working closely with CBOs, our community-based organisations, and those statutory services. And again, it's over in the Dundee area. And what they have is that part of that wider community mapping. What have we got? Because actually there's loads out there, but people, the system is so complicated, people do not know how to access it, or they're being diverted round the wrong way or round so many houses to get there in the first place that actually it takes a lot of energy and it also takes a lot of knowledge for the particular worker that maybe you have approached for support to be able to signpost you in the right way or provide you with the right support. So one simple thing I think that they're piloting at the minute is a system called FORT, and that's where the community-based organisations are actually the first point of contact, and then they're looking at how then families can be supported, almost like, I suppose, triaging the needs of families and looking at and advocating as well for the type of support that they need. I think they thought that in Dundee that would be more beneficial because a lot of the community-based organisations had a better understanding of the cultural dynamic of some of the communities and the key issues that affected some sections within those communities. They had a better relationship with families and it was more accessible, that they understood, I suppose, that actually not everything needed to go straight. I think that the default position is if it's mental health, it goes to CAMHS. But in actual fact, it was about looking at, well, what is causing this family's distress? Is it because, mum and dad have got complex kind of needs themselves, they're under a lot of financial pressure, and therefore the children are experiencing distress because of that? Well, what then would be better supported? Do we refer this child into CAMHS, or actually do we support the parents so that they can support their child better? So it is kind of taking that more holistic approach to being able to understand what the social and environmental factors and the cultural factors are to that were impacting on this child's well-being. This is a pilot that's ongoing, but it's that whole, you know, trying to make the system more accessible and having one point of access and so that families aren't having to go around the houses. So I suppose there's different things that we can do. And I think that co-production piece, that having conversations with those communities and families, is going to be really important for the localities in terms of understanding what's going to work best.
Thank you. I'm sorry, we need to move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed. Committee members, can you keep your questions short, please, and to the point and direct them, and then we'll get round everyone. Can I come to Evelyn Tweed?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel, and thanks for all your information so far and your answers. It's been really helpful. My question is around waiting times. Now, it's great that the Scottish Government have made significant announcements about CAMHS, about funding. However, in my area and in other areas across Scotland, there are still significant waiting lists. And I know that some of you have touched on this in previous answers, but what's your view on this? Why are there still significant waiting lists, and what can we do to help them? And I would like to direct that to Joanne Smith, please.
Thanks very much for that. We are obviously very concerned about the demand for crisis services. I'm just going to need to plug my computer in. Sorry about that. Just one moment. ASPCC would argue strongly for investment in the early years. We recognise there's a balance to be struck between meeting that immediate crisis, but we also do need to have that long-term strategic approach that's informed by the evidence that a lot of mental health difficulties have their roots in infancy. If we can get it right in the early years, we can lay the foundations for all future wellbeing and health, thus stripping out the demand for crisis intervention later on. Now, other people have spoke about how we find ourselves in this crisis. You know, there's universal consensus around the role of poverty in impacting on family functioning and child wellbeing. We would endorse the findings from Catherine Trebek's report that called for fiscal decisions that prioritise wellbeing over growth. That's what's required to improve mental health and wellbeing of children. And we also really need heavy investment in preventative services. This committee is really well placed to actually facilitate some of that thinking, because I know you're carrying out the review into perinatal mental health. And that's a really exciting opportunity to accelerate long-standing ambitions around prevention. We have an opportunity there to build mental health infrastructure in an integrated early years offer that will support families at a point where we're likely to have the biggest impact and really kind of drive down the demand for our crisis services and therefore our waiting list. So I think it is a note of caution. I think it is worth pointing out that, you know, health visitor data as we emerge from lockdown shows an increase in developmental delay for children who are starting nursery. That, if not treated and responded to quickly, will grow and continue through life. Therefore, stacking up that demand, continuous demand for crisis intervention later on, we need to have a robust universal early years offer for families now. And actually, in Scotland, we've got really strong foundations to build on because of the priority given to the early years by the Scottish Government over the last 10 years. So I think it's there that we can make the biggest difference because, of course, the children that we're failing now are going to go on to have children, and so that cycle continues. So we would make a plea for the early years to be a priority for this committee's inquiry.
Thank you. Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. And what support should be available for children and young people when there is a big gap and when they achieve their CAMHS appointment? And could I maybe ask Joanne Smith again, please?
What can be provided for children where there is a gap in the availability of support?
Yes, like if there's a long wait and a child or a young person has a long time to wait, what could we do in between to help?
Yes, I think that it's really critically important that we have that local community and family support available. Again, because of our family support work in Scotland, we have really highly skilled professionals who are very grounded in communities and have those local relationships that allow them to get alongside families and provide that more holistic, integrated support. They have the relationships. A lot of the work that needs to be done for a kind of multi-agency integrated approach is happening locally, so we do need to promote that and invest in that. There are good plans to do that and good examples of the kind of the holistic family services around GP practices, for example. But for that to work, we're going to need significant levels of investment, and it's unlikely that the £500 million wellbeing fund is sufficient to plug existing gaps as well as build capacity. So I think we've got the vision right in terms of what good community mental health services look like. It's whether we're investing to deliver those in practice.
And can I bring in Alex Cumming?
Yes, thanks, Convener. And just to follow up on a couple of those last points, our in partnership with Young Scots, the Youth Commission into Mental Health Services, 3 years ago recommended, and the government accepted these recommendations around a multi-agency approach to triage, which is a kind of comment that Shelley and Joanne have both made. And again, while there are some good examples there, both Shelley and Joanne have obviously commented on it, you know, that's happening in isolation, and is that happening everywhere? So is that one key aspect that's going to kind of reduce the waiting times and reduce the number of people on waiting lists? I think once someone is waiting for a kind of an assessment, no matter what that might be, it's about having that consistent point of contact for them. Sam mentioned earlier on about that kind of pinball, you know, going from kind of pillar to post, etc. So once they are in that system, again, it's about regular communication, giving them updates and having a consistent point of contact for support and help once they are in that particular system.
Thank you. I'm afraid we're going to have to move on to the next theme. We are rapidly eating up our time. I'll try and pick up people as we go along. Can I move on to the theme of rejected referrals with Gillian Mackay?
Thank you, Convener. In their submission, the Royal College of Psychiatrists said there's a wide variation by Health Board in how CAMHS set its expectation who would likely need care in its services, and this was dependent on particular geographies, but also availability of resource. To what extent does regional variation impact rejected referrals? I go to Joanne Smith on that, please.
Thank you, Gillian.
Yes, I mean, of course, it is a postcode lottery in terms of what's available locally, and I do think that we really do need to understand quite urgently what is the local capacity across Halesport. There are examples of good practice and people who are working well to build kind of multi-agency hub of practice, but obviously the levels of provision are variable across the country, and I think we need to have a clear national picture of what that looks like, because we don't want to be scattergun in how we're using any new investment. It's really important. The Scottish Government recognise that this is a huge challenge and that we need to be take a tiered approach to implementing the changes. So that's really going to require a stock take of where local areas are, what are the local infrastructure, and how do we best enhance that? Because I would make the point that there's, as I mentioned before, a similar expansion of perinatal and infant mental health services taking place, and all the same issues that exist within CAMHS around recruitment and retention and capacity issues exists within the perinatal expansion as well. So we've got two parallel processes happening, both trying to recruit in large numbers. The likelihood is that people will be moving between Halesport and between disciplines rather than actually building capacity, because the specialism doesn't currently exist. So to make it work in practice, we need to be meeting clinical needs, of course, but also thinking seriously about education, recruitment and training, so that we can be confident that actually any new posts can be filled by new capacity rather than kind of moving deck chairs as we get.
Thank you, and Paul O'Kane will be picking up on some of the themes around workforce. Can I bring in Alex Cumming on this, because I think it's important that we do hear from CAMHS on this.
Yeah, I suppose the just to kind of follow what Joanna said, the around rejected referrals is why have we got rejected referrals in the first place, and obviously last year through the programme boards and now the joint delivery boards, there was new CAMHS criteria that was launched, but I think, or what we're still seeing, is that there is a lack of understanding there within some areas around I guess what CAMHS is for, and certainly within the wider public. People, understandably, families want best for their children, young people want to try and get the best support, but is it the right support for them? And I think that's where this whole system, a couple of other contributors have mentioned whole systems, and that's where I think we need to kind of look at everything and just, whether it be through this triage system, directing people to the most appropriate thing and the most appropriate support, I think, stops people, that disappointment. And again, we want to avoid that. No young person, no family should be rejected from CAMHS, and I think it's just about trying to upskill, that information and knowledge across, across the widest community in Scotland about what CAMHS can do, and what's a school counsellor there to do, what's a school nurse there to do. During COVID and prior to Christmas, lots of people through their letterbox have had that really helpful leaflet from NHS around where do you go, if you got a dentist appointment, or if you've got, where do you go during this period? So actually, is it the same thing around, child and adolescent mental health and that breadth of services and that tiered approach that we know that we think is going to work, and we know is going to work because there's good evidence for it. But whether it be through primary care or other referral routes, we're still sending young people and sending families to CAMHS when actually they should be going elsewhere. So there's still a bit of an upskilling. It's no one's fault. It's because they think that's the best place for them, or they think there's actually, they don't have the understanding of what's available locally. But I think that's really, really important. It's just about information and knowledge across the sector.
Thank you, Alex. Can I just correct myself? I said CAMHS when I should have said SAM H. So apologies for that. Gillian, can I bring you back in?
Thank you, convener. The other thing I wanted to touch on was data. The lack of data on rejected referrals has been highlighted to the committee. We have a sense of whether children and young people from certain backgrounds with certain conditions or those marginalised groups are more likely to be rejected for support. And could I maybe go to Dr. Stark on that one?
Thank you. Dr. Stark.
I think data is really useful because with data we can actually see what's going on. I think the prevalence of mental health difficulties is actually probably much higher than we realise. I think what we often see is the tip of the iceberg, but actually a lot of children could be doing a lot more support, and we need to be looking at not sort of mental illness, we need to be looking at mental health as well-being and making all children feel a bit more secure, happier and more resilient to developing mental illness, which we're not at the moment. I think the difficulties with what we've been seeing, waiting times and everything else, I think we need to stop the flow of patients coming. And I'm not sure how we would get the data of how many people there are, but I think probably schools is the best place, because at schools you get a much broader and you can see which socioeconomic groups are more affected. I think there's definitely needing to be more input for care experienced children and families that have got less support. And if your parents have mental health difficulties, then they're not equipped to give you as much support because they've got their own difficulties. So it isn't always just one group, though. I think cross society there's difficulties, and there will be some children who you might think, well, they've got professional parents, they're fine, but actually they're having difficulties too. So I think no child should be excluded, and we should be looking universally, but there are definitely groups that need more intervention, particularly care experienced and children living in poverty. And obviously that group's coming up.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions around the integrated services partnership. A lot of you have mentioned this already. So Emma, if you can direct your questions and pick up on some of the things that people have said, that would be great. Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Thanks. Good morning, everybody. Yeah, you've touched a lot on what I was going to ask about integrated services and partnerships. And Dr. Stark has just mentioned poverty, and we know that's a huge contribution factor for mental poor health. Lots of the submissions included better integrated services and partnerships, and the promise in our papers, it talks about the promise having 10 points, that 10 principles on intensive family support that will be embedded into practice. And some of those, I won't read out all 10, but about community-based, responsive and timely, working with family assets, empowerment and agency. So I'm interested to know, and including that some of our submissions, one of the submissions that came from Darren Littleland of Rees and Galloway, speaking about multi-agency strategic planning and implementation at local levels. So we know that if people work better together, that will support better outcomes. So I'm wondering what impact would more integrated services have on the demand for CAMHS and the delivery of services? And I guess we'll go with that one first, and then I'll wind the other two questions into one.
Yep. Would you like to direct your question?
Yes, I was thinking about Shelley Buckley and then maybe Sam March.
Okay, thank you. Shelley.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think integration of services is incredibly important because having that range of perspectives in terms of understanding the needs of your community is really important for our special services. So having, for example, social work, occupational therapy, CPN, psychiatry, psychology, all working together is really important to be able to come at a problem from a variety of different perspectives. And identify accurately what the needs of those families are. But there's something else around integration. It's that integration between at all levels. So, for example, during the summertime, we had a focus on mental health promotion, and using some of the Scottish Government money around the Get Into Summer programme, we worked alongside Thrive Edinburgh and CAM Services and 22 community-based organisations. And actually, the focus was very much on, so we used a tool called StressLess. So essentially, it's a mental health promotion tool. So it's about skilling up staff around how you talk about how to promote mental health as opposed to identifying mental health problems and symptoms around mental health. Because what we did know was that the 2,500 young people that we worked with
all experienced mental health problems. They all came from those family backgrounds where there is a lot of adversity, distress, and poverty. So there, we knew that there were multiple challenges. But one of the, by taking a mental health promotion approach, the outcomes of that were incredible, actually, because it was a very short project. But what it did was it really did address, I suppose, the risks that we often mitigate with that inequality and poverty. We found that staff, in a really fast period of time, all started to work together really quickly to identify the range of needs and share resources and share ideas and share skills, because we got them together, working together across all of the different teams in a really short space of time. So this is over a period of 2 months. So that was really important. Because what they had identified in some areas, they didn't have certain resources, they didn't have access to certain skills and knowledge, but they very quickly formulated those partnerships. What we identified was that they knew those groups really, really well. So they knew, for example, that certain families, there was huge confidence issues in the young people because perhaps they were young carers, perhaps they were dealing with multiple difficulties themselves. So they were able to facilitate that support right from the young person's front door and support the parents to enable that child to engage, I suppose, in those community activities that enabled them to build their confidence over the summer. They were enabled to engage in activities and programmes that they wouldn't otherwise have been able to afford because it was part of a wide, universally accessible programme. So they're able to do leisure activities, their travel, their food was all included. So the participation and the engagement, there was no shame or stigma, and young people were supported to engage on in new things that they were perhaps afraid or would have been frightened to do. But it was also, it also enabled them to revisit things that they hadn't done pre-COVID but were really, really nervous to do again, like things like getting into the swimming pool. You know, going to the sea for the first, we're not talking about really complicated issues here, but actually the feedback from the young people was overwhelming in terms of how that enhanced their well-being. So I think this has been highlighted, I think, by quite a lot of the panel members. It's about talking about well-being and promoting those protective factors that we know will enhance the well-being of young people. That is what is going to reduce the risk. That is what is what's going to support parents. We enabled parents to engage with their children in those social activities and give them those positive experiences. And the youth workers were able to support them with that because they had that specialist long arm support from specialist mental health professionals. And they also had been given these tools to enable them through the StressLess programme to engage in proactive ways. And we also acknowledged that the young people themselves came back and said, actually, it's been so nice to be able to talk about mental health in a different way, because we always focus on the things that are wrong, the things that are negative. But actually, you know, mental health is also about doing things that help you to feel good about yourself, understanding who the right people are that are good for you and who you can talk to, who's the best person to be your friend, you know, and to have the confidence to share your thoughts with your friends. This, it was about taking that different approach, changing that narrative, having a different conversation. And the consequences of that in that really short space of time were really empowering, because you know, you had empowerment between organisations, you had empowering conversations between the communities and the organisations. And it's had a long-term effect in that a lot of this work then has went on beyond the project and has now seeped into the schools and other parts of the community. And children have been brought on as sessional staff, and they've had employment opportunities from this activity. So it just shows you that actually really small initiatives at ground level, using that co-production and interdisciplinary approach, can have a massive impact whenever we look at strengthening those protective factors.
Thank you. Can I bring in Sam March?
A lot of our, I would say there's a lot of integration in terms of children's services and different agencies, including with the third sector, be it via Promise Board, Child Protection, and different groups within children's services, and we continue to meet, plan, share data, and jointly commission where possible. The conversation around things like community mental health is a multi-agency conversation. The last conversation about sharing data with CALMS, we do have their local data, and you know, are using that to look at gaps. There is a high level of integration, including with the third sector. There are also some really good examples that other people have talked about in terms of multi-agency hubs. We have an early support hub that is newly set up, really to provide early intervention. There are other really good examples across the country. The triaging that Alec mentioned, and my view is that signposting when you reach CALMS is not really going to cut it. Triaging is a multi-agency triaging is really essential. So that's an area for development. And you know, we do get money into local authorities that is sliced up in terms of this is for this and this is for that and this is your attainment challenge, and that can and it's short term only, and that can be a challenge in terms of prevention and early intervention as well, and joint commissioning.
Emma, with apologies, I'm not going to come back to you because we have got three more committee members that haven't asked questions yet. If I have time at the end, I'll bring you back in. Can I move on to inequalities and access in mental health care? Carol Mockin. Carol.
Hi there. Thanks so much for this. And I will, obviously, it's a huge area, but I know we don't have a lot of time. So I'm going to be quite direct in the question. We know that people from backgrounds, poorer backgrounds, you've mentioned children with learning disability, have more difficulty accessing mental health services. I'd be really interested to know what we can do to improve this for children, young people and their families. I'm particularly interested, we've talked a lot about, or certainly mentioned about the sort of cuts to local authorities. I'd be really keen to know if people think that this has affected people. It's an issue that I'm quite concerned about. And possibly, I can't see everybody now.
Maybe it'd be a good idea to bring in Susie Fitton, given the can I come to Susie first of all? And if anyone else wants to come in, please use the chat box. Susie.
So yes, yeah, so our research during lockdown highlighted that a particular issue for families of disabled children and young people around cuts to social care provision. So some of that was austerity driven and some of it was as a response to the pandemic. But certainly we found evidence of very concerning situations where children and young people's mental health had been directly impacted, either because their own social care support had been stopped or reduced, or the social care support that their parents or parents relied on had been suddenly reduced, in some cases overnight actually. So people had no prior warning that the support that they received through social care, local authority provision largely, would be removed. And families were left in really, really, really quite desperate situations because of this, with parents suddenly being thrust into caring responsibilities for young disabled people and trying to juggle those caring responsibilities with home working and potentially homeschooling of other children. So yes, I think the strain on local authorities, particularly in relation to the provision of social care support, has really exacerbated mental strain for families, and in some situations has made either pre-existing or pandemic-related mental health issues worse for disabled children and young people. The other pandemic-related issues that created mental strain included families struggling to get food and medicine, actually. So many families that experience disability, so either because of a disabled child or because of a disabled parent, reported to us that they were struggling to get the food and medicine required by a disabled person in the family. And that created an additional layer of anxiety and stress on families, particularly in the early part of the pandemic, when it was very difficult to get delivery slots and very difficult for some disabled people to access supermarkets, and particularly people who were shielding, they found it very difficult to get the support that they needed, and that only exacerbated mental strain. Disabled parents were very concerned that they might lose their job, and financial pressures during the, particularly during the beginning of the pandemic, only kind of served to exacerbate family strain. And then, you know, in that context where services that families were previously reliant on, so services that were accessed either via the school or via respite provision, families reported to us that they felt abandoned by statutory services, particularly local authority provision, at a time when they most needed support. And that feeling of abandonment hasn't abated for some families, even though services in some cases have been reinstated. That feeling that emergency planning did not cater for the needs of families of disabled children and young people has left people very fearful for the future, particularly if we have to go into lockdown at another period.
Thank you. Can I bring in Sam March, please?
I'll be very quick. I think you asked about, is there anything that could be done in terms of, I do have a slight concern about the suitability of the school counselling and whether we need to be more flexible in services provided. The initial spec is very, very fixed on talk therapy, and there's been a lot of discussion in the networks about alternative types of therapies being more accessible for some children and young people. So that's an ongoing consideration. And you asked about local authority budgets, and I would say yes, in a range of ways. And the most obvious statistic I have at my hand is educational psychology numbers have dropped by 20 across the country since 2017 and 2018. And we have a significant role in mental health and wellbeing work on a whole variety of levels, including supporting the most vulnerable children and families as part of our casework, and a whole number of other involvements, which I've hopefully articulated some of.
Thank you. Carol, with apologies, I'm not going to be able to come back to you because we still have two committee members I want to ask questions. We were going to move on to specific COVID-19 with Sandesh Gulhani, but we're having difficulties with the broadcast and getting them back. So can I come to my deputy convener, Paul O'Kane, to save the day? Oh, you are here, Sandesh. Great. I thought we couldn't see you, so I'll come to you, Sandesh.
Thank you, convener. COVID-19 obviously would take up the entire session that we have. So I'm going to really focus my question. We've heard about the impact that COVID has had on people with disabilities, and it's been very well articulated. But what I would like to know is what impact COVID-19 has had on young children based on their ethnicity, and how do we get this data and information around the prevalence of mental health, not just in the ethnic community, but throughout the children in Scotland. I suppose that is questions for everyone, convener. If there's anyone in particular,
yeah,
that has
sadly we can't go around everyone, so I'll maybe go to Joanne Smith first on that, and if anyone else wants to chip in, please put an R in the chat box, Joanne.
Thank you. Yeah, really important question. I think that we recognise that there's real limitations in how we disaggregate data related to who's accessing mental health. Much better at that. But we know that there are kind of cultural issues that would make it less likely that people will access a referral pathway that starts at the GP, for example. So some people that would be, they wouldn't be reaching out for help. It would be much more suitable to be able to provide a community-based resource that is embedded within local kind of cultures and practices. So I think that that is obviously a massive issue. We have had a range of reviews and committee inquiries over the last 15 years that have flagged the lack of comprehensive data, both on spend and planning, but also on outcomes. That is an area warranting urgent attention. And I think that by getting that much more kind of robust evidence base, again, we can design a system that would reach those groups who don't typically access specialist services. I would make the point about looked after children, of course, because in the year of the promise, we know that where children's mental health difficulties coexist alongside other adversity, then they tend not to be accessing specialist care either. They're often excluded from specialist care where their psychological distress is manifesting as risk-taking, for example, or hypervigilance. So we find a whole tier of very vulnerable children and young people who are not able to access mental health specialist care and whose difficulties aren't even understood in those terms, so they're often excluded from therapeutic support. And these children are much more likely to find themselves interfacing with police, perhaps, or with social work services. So any expansion of CAMHS really needs to be coupled with that protection in our statutory services, because if we don't have that expansion within communities, then we further exacerbate what's already considered to be a two-tier system of support for children. If we want to realise the promise, then we really do need to be prioritising investment within communities. But I'd also just make one final point about looked after children. Given that the promise is really what we have to be focused on, the NSPCC are trialling an innovative multi-agency intervention for very young children in care. It's multi-agency in that it's co-located. It's a one team with NHS staff, social work staff, the family support workers, and they are working together to ensure that there is timely assessment of need, appropriate care, and also to increase the quality of decision making around permanence. This model is being tested by a randomised controlled trial, which is due to report next year. But the findings tell us that the integration of services to make sure that we're meeting marginalised groups requires dedicated time, resource, and also strategic leadership. Integration, it won't happen on its own. We need to make genuine efforts to build multi-agency teams to strip away the barriers that exist in multi-agency working, because we've aspired to do it for a long time. But in many areas, we're not delivering that. So I would point to kind of really innovative work that's underway to make an integrated model work in practice. And in the case of the Glasgow Infant and Family Team, it's really working with those most vulnerable families to ensure that both baby and parents get a therapeutic input. And in doing so, the evidence suggests that we're improving outcomes for both that sibling and for subsequent siblings. So it's that type of innovation we need to be pointing to. I really think that there are really good examples that could drive that shift towards prevention that we've long aspired to in Scotland.
Thank you. We're reaching the end of our session. I'm going to have to extend it by about 10 minutes, but I can't do any more than that because we've got so another panel and so much else to get through in our agenda. Can I come to Shelley Buckley quickly in response to Sandesh, and then I'll need to move on to questions from Paul.
I'll be really, really brief. I think the data is important, but also I think the difficulty we have is we need to address the issue of cultural humility within services. And that means speaking the same language of different communities. The language we currently use around mental health and wellbeing is westernised, and it's culturally fixed within our communities, our culture in the UK. We are currently doing some research and some project work with, for example, young refugees, and we're having to strip right back the language because mental health doesn't even translate. You know, the how we articulate, how we treat, how we assess, how we understand mental health from my perspective and from the perspective of, say, a young Vietnamese person is completely different. So I think there is a huge amount of work to be done within mental health services generally, and actually just across the board, in terms of truly understanding what well-being, emotional well-being, spiritual well-being, all of those things look like for different communities. And instead of talking about cultural competence, which assumes that we somehow get to a point where we know what we're talking about, actually we don't. We need to talk about cultural humility and supporting that criticality within services. And I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you. Can I come to Paul O'Kane for a question on workforce? And if you can direct your question, please, Paul.
Thank you, convener. I'm moving a few questions together just for the sake of time. But essentially, we've seen the programme for government commit to 320 additional staff over 5 years in CAM services. I suppose the first part of this is there a sense that that's enough in terms of the next 5 year period, and able to grow and services and meet demand? But also, I think maybe a more open question is, you know, what levels of recruitment do we think are required, and what sort of roles, are there additional roles that we are not already seeing in the system that would help to, you know, reduce pressure on waiting lists? But I'll maybe come to Mary first, if that's possible.
Thank you. Mary?
I think one of the things we have to do, and we've talked already, is stopping the flow. So the community services are very important to try and stop children needing CAMHS in the first place. We're seeing increasing numbers of patients being referred, so the waiting lists are going to go up. It's difficult to magic up more and more psychiatrists and psychologists. So we will need to have a look at how we do this. How are we going to support our mental health colleagues? And we maybe need to be thinking, at the moment, CAMHS is separate from paediatrics. Maybe they need to be joined together so we can work closely together of what different bits can do so that we have a much more unified service and that we have better links with the community services, because most paediatricians don't know what's out there for families in the community. So we need to be joining things up. We need single point contacts for people in the community so we can support families in a much better, more robust way.
Thank you. And can I bring in Alex Cumming?
Yeah, I just wanted to reference in relation to types of roles, and Sam March mentioned this earlier on. We're currently in a number of areas across Scotland piloting a distress brief intervention service with under 16s. And I think while absolutely there's the need for the clinical roles and to kind of bolster the support within those settings, I guess we need to, you know, as Dr. Stark has mentioned, it's also the non-clinical roles within the community and within different services. So we as a number of other third sector providers are involved in the delivery of the distress brief intervention services and programmes across Scotland. And I think the under 16 pilots will be really interesting over the next kind of 12 months. And I think those are the roles, while that's obviously a slightly higher escalated level of support, when obviously a young person is in distress, not quite at that crisis level, and definitely not the kind of tier one and tier two, but I think those types of roles are going to be really important to support all the statutory services going forward.
Thank you. And can I bring in Sam March?
Thanks. Alec mentioned DBI, and I do think that's one of the services, I agree, that's one of the services that needs to be very closely looked at in terms of, you know, because conversations we've had can provide support, which is obviously the key thing, and prevent escalation to CAMHS in some of the, but it does need an independent evaluation as well. I'm not sure the answer in terms of is that enough. I think we're dealing with the pressures, the need and the pressures from COVID. So we need a balanced approach that includes focus on early intervention as well, and the community mental health fund as well needs to be not become the poor relation, because these supports are ultimately what we want, our aspiration over the next 10-15 years, and where children, young people and families will feel most comfortable getting support.
Thank you. And can I come to Shelley Buckley?
Speakers have said there, I think that task sharing to community-based organisations is really important, but that has to be done in the context of really robust community mapping, so that we're identifying the needs of communities and making sure that the correct interventions are being placed in the right, people are being skilled up in the correct interventions that are going to have the biggest impact for the greatest amount of people within those communities, because again, we're not dealing with infinite resources here as well. So I think that community mapping, that assessment is crucial for underpinning that. There's also that piece about what Sam's talked about, is quality assuring. So any specialist intervention is making sure almost that there is that strengthened collaboration between those specialist mental health providers who are skilled in these areas to support that warm arm, that coach, if you like, to the community-based organisations. And it also improves then that flow, I suppose, of prioritising and ensuring that people are getting the right support from CAMHS, the right people are getting the right support from CAMHS at the right time. There's that piece around mental health promotion and wellbeing, that universal piece that we need to change the narrative, we need to strengthen those things that we know protect communities, protect people, like free access to travel, make it easy to get, make sure that young people have access to leisure, and activities, and that parents who are under financial pressure are not worrying about these things, that children are not hanging about the streets, and that they're engaged in meaningful, purposeful activity that is fun and engaging for them. All of these things, they're simple, but they make a massive difference. Making sure that the environments that people live in are safe, safe access to green space, safe access to those community spaces, have got meaningful activity in places where families can be together. And making sure, I suppose, that we are kind of having that kind of two-pronged kind of approach, and that we're filling, I suppose, that plugging that gap in the middle and in the interim period where those people aren't kind of languishing, that are kind of in between services, that we're able to meet those needs, but at the same time reduce that bottleneck into services. So we're playing the long game here. Essentially, we hope that the actions and activities that we take now, where we can, if we focus on that early intervention in perinatal and health services, and we get it right in those communities, that in 10-15 years, that is when we will see the benefit of what we do. But we have to kind of hold tight and hold strong in that and be committed.
Thank you. We have run well over time, so I am going to have to bring this session to a close. I want to thank every single one of you for the very compelling evidence that you've given us this morning, and for the time you've spent. We're going to suspend this broadcast briefly for until 10 past. Welcome back to this meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Second panel we have today will focus on the health and wellbeing of care experienced children and young people. And a welcome to the committee, Jackie Brock, the Chief Operations Officer for the Promise Scotland, Helen Happer, the Chief Inspector of the Care Inspectorate, and Lucy Hughes, the Policy Development Coordinator for Who Cares Scotland, and Kate McKinnon, from CELSIS, the Policy Association from CELSIS. Good morning to you all, and thank you for coming along this morning. So last night we had a private session, an informal session with a lot of care experienced young people. And one of the things that really struck me was a comment made by a young woman who said that local authorities know when care experienced young people are leaving the care system. They know how many, they know when it's going to happen, and they know that at that point it's a very difficult time, and it's a difficult time for them in terms of mental health. Why isn't there anything in place at that time that they can, you know, that they can get in touch with somebody if their mental health is suffering? And it struck me that, you know, do looked after children and young people and care leavers have access to that intensive support that ensures that the health needs are fully met. And that's something that the Promise wants to be delivered. Can I put that question to you all and reflect on what that young woman said? Because it struck me as being a very sensible approach. Can I come to Helen Happer first of all?
Certainly, yes, thank you. Yeah, I think that is a salutary statement really for that young woman to say, because it does sound so simple. We know that it's very, very challenging period of time for any young person. If you're leaving a situation where you don't have the ongoing family support that that your peers have, that makes it triply difficult for you. One of the challenges that's around is that we know that young people need to make mistakes, they need to try things out and see what works for them and what doesn't. And that means sometimes leaving, coming back, and you know, you don't make decisions and then those just work out for you. That's extraordinarily difficult for local authorities to manage, because maintaining foster placements, for example, where children leave but have the option to come back is very, very difficult. So there are some structural challenges really in providing that, and there are real structural challenges in terms of housing and in terms of financial support for children and young people. One thing that has been very clear for us is that our evidence is in a lot of inspection activity has shown that the outcomes for older young people, that care leaving group, and young people in continuing care are much poorer than the outcomes for other children. We've seen lots of improvements in the outcomes for younger children as they're moving up through the care system, but it's older young people, their outcomes seem stubbornly stuck. Now, we do believe that there's a lot of goodwill around, but the structure that is around the pathway planning process that exists for care leavers is out of date. It hasn't been reviewed. It's been in place since 2003 and hasn't been reviewed. And it isn't as linked, we believe, it isn't as linked to the getting it right for every child approach that we believe has been quite successful in helping staff work together across different services more effectively to plan for younger children. So that's certainly an area that the committee might want to have a think about its time really to address that. And that might help that forward planning that I think that young woman that spoke to you was probably thinking about, that forward planning of knowing that everything is not going to go smoothly, because it doesn't for anybody, and allowing those kind of contingencies when young people need that extra support.
Thank you, Helen. Can I move on to Jackie Brock?
Thank you, convener, and thank you very much for telling us what you heard last night from the group of young people, because obviously, you know, that they reminded us this should be reasonably straightforward. Helen's set out some of the complexities, but I think it is important to remember that the legislation is in place to fulfil what that young person asked you for. There are rights in place for young people leaving the care system, or certainly in transition, for example, from the children's services to adult services. So what's preventing that happening? Now, of course, there will be issues around resources, etc. There are also challenges that Helen set out, in that it's very clear that young people, if you like, need a relationship-based approach that will set down and say, right, what's your situation? Where do we need to go to support you? Is it into independent living? Is it to remain with your foster carers for longer? Is it to support you to navigate through school and then into college, etc.? So there is an intensity around the support that's needed, but that intensity is going to be worth it in relation to improving outcomes, which, as we all know, are completely unacceptable for young people in the care system. So as you can see, hopefully, within the promise as a whole and the plan for 21-24 and the change programme that we produced last year, there's a real sense that the framework is in place. We do have laws, duties, we have commitment, we have principles set out for what we should be achieving. So what is necessary to make this happen? I think there certainly needs to be a really clear focus on this group of young people, and this isn't a large group of young people at national level, but really honing in on, okay, how can we get it right for this group of young people that I suspect that you were talking to last night, convener, that 16 to 17 year old age group. We know that transition at that age, together with the complexities of adolescence, the development, et cetera, we know that services do not build themselves around young people at that stage. There is the children and family service, and the legal requirements there. And then there are a set of adult services. You lose potentially the scaffolding of school. And so how do we help a young person transition into that more complex system? But this there's a lot of progress in place. There's some amazing work around through care and aftercare in place. As Helen has pointed out, there's the inspection and regulatory framework as well that should support it. But I think we really do need and again, a focus on keeping the promise and the very clear suggestions, proposals, plan that is in place through the promise, that let's use the inspection and regulation system to figure out what matters for children and young people. Let's ask them, as you did, convener, last night, and then let's look at how we can deliver that. And that will mean some changes in relation to how the workforce is organised. But we're really convinced through all our discussions that the workforce absolutely know and desperate to deliver their services differently in line with the needs of those young people. So we're hopeful within the Promise Scotland, but we cannot keep hearing, frankly, the same easy, what should be easy questions, easy for you to have answered last night. We can't keep hearing this because what the young person said to you is perfectly reasonable in terms of their life experience and the support that they need. Thank you.
Jackie, before I move on to your colleagues, just talking about the promise, has COVID-19 impacted on the implementation of it?
Yeah, thank you, convener, for the opportunity to answer that. You know, the promise was accepted in full in February 2020, and you know, keep the promise by 2030 at the very latest is a commitment that's been made from the First Minister and across government, and indeed all parties within the Scottish Parliament. And then, of course, the pandemic hit. What we found over the last 2 years, convener, is that undoubtedly the workforce in its broader sense has had to shift into supporting an emergency, and that's fine. But again, some really incredible work, despite that, has been done to to maintain progress. We also do have the National Care Service consultation that is also distracted, possibly from, or certainly raised additional questions about how the promise is going to be achieved, which hasn't always been helpful. I think just so it's mixed, convener. And if I could just make a brief additional point, what we've also found and we reported in the change programme is that, if you like, the real challenges in the system that the promise is designed to achieve, they've been stretched to the limit, I think. In terms of those challenges, we've seen them exacerbated through the pandemic. So the experience, for example, of children and young people in children's houses has been really stretched to the limit in terms of, for example, many of the workforce being forced to wear PPE, etc. So the least like a home, you know, you've seen, of course, the recent reporting around the use of restraint, which clearly is a symptom of the strains and stresses within that have been exacerbated through the pandemic. So it's not been helpful, convener, at all. Clearly, it's fantastic that Keeping the Promise is one of the key programmes within the government's COVID-19 recovery programme, but it's not been helpful, and we still have a commitment to deliver by 2030. So really, your inquiry and evidence, and this really in terms of building on what the promise has said and accelerating progress, will be desperately needed. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Lucy Hughes?
Thank you, convener, and thank you for inviting us to be here today to give evidence. Just for those who aren't aware of our work, Who Cares Scotland is an independent advocacy and a national membership organisation for care experienced people, and some of our members were those that you spoke to last night. I think one of the things I just want to address, first of all, is the language that we're using around the same kind of system language, care leaver. We're assuming that transitions will happen at 16, 17 for young people in care, and I think the message that we're hearing from our members time and time again is that care experience is a lifelong experience. It doesn't just cut off because you turn a certain age. And what we really want to do is work with the promise and with partners to understand how can we encourage the sector and the system of support to think about people beyond those age brackets, beyond, you know, what age someone is a young person coming into an adult. And actually the support might not change that they need as they are at the moment aging out of services. So I think just on the point on transitions, your initial question there and what the member spoke to you last night, is that that support really isn't in place for a lot of older care experienced people. You know, we saw throughout COVID, we had a helpline that was set up, and the majority of calls were from people over 20 with care experience who had absolutely no statutory support in place, were not known to maybe adult social work, but had left care at some point in their teens or earlier in childhood. And I think there does need to be acknowledgement of the committee that, you know, these older care experienced people, whether you're talking 16, whether you're talking in 20s or older, do also have significant mental health needs and health needs that aren't being addressed and sometimes are an invisible population, I think, to statutory services. So I would encourage the committee to think about care experience beyond childhood and actually as a lifelong need and in terms of what we should be doing to address that. And just on Jackie's point around the National Care Service, we do see that as an opportunity. If policy cohesion is kind of actually addressed in terms of matching up what's currently happening under the promise, to join up the approach that we have across lifetime from cradle to grave in the same way that we have with the NHS in some ways as well, and really just linking that up, you know, someone shouldn't be leaving care and then that's their support stopped. It should be a lifelong offer. People in their adulthood can be affected by the experience in their childhood, and that's something that, you know, we need to acknowledge and kind of get beyond that care leaver language, which I think we are still very much stuck in as a nation.
Yeah, and that came across very clear last night in speaking to the young people. Can I come to Kate McKinnon?
Thank you, and thanks for inviting me here to give evidence today. Really agree with some of the points that my colleague Scotland has made. I think it's really important to think about what all children and young people in their life. And we know that in Scotland, for non-care experienced children and young people, the average age of leaving home is around 26 and rising. And that's nearly 10 years younger for care experienced children. Average age. And so when we're thinking about the health and well-being of care experience young people and what they need as they grow up, it's really important to think about the wider stresses that they experience in their lives when they are having to move out so much younger and in with support that is sometimes disappearing overnight in comparison to when they're in comparison to their peers who might have support that goes on for years and decades and lifetimes from their parents. So the gap between what is a really progressive and aspirational in many senses policy and legislative landscape and how that is felt in the lives of children and young people, I think is really important. And thanks to Jackie at the Promise for mentioning that as well. So there is a real need for a sustaining an agenda to implement the policies and the legislation that we have that we know is really important. And some of that will involve systematic change. We know that there is too often for care experience people who are more likely to have experienced trauma and adversity and disrupted relationships, a drop off when they move between services that are for children and services for adults. And that's across the board in terms of care and protection needs or health. And so ensuring that we have systems in place that meet the needs of a child or young person and not expecting the needs of children and young people to be dependent on the services that are available is really crucial. And the other aspect of the importance of implementing that legislation that I would also mention is that as well as listening, it's so important crucially to be listening to children and young people who are able to meet with the care experience people last night and describe the experiences that really, as we all agree, shouldn't be happening. And that is the kind of the absolute core of implementing any change. And I would say secondary to that, really important to be listening to and supporting practitioners about what the barriers that they're experiencing in their day-to-day practice are preventing implementing the legislation that we already have. Thirdly, we spoke at the beginning around the data that we have on care experienced people and leaving care and the needs in their life journeys. And I would mention briefly that there is CELSIS are publishing research, which I think is going to Scottish Government this week, around this gap and what we understand about how many young people are becoming assessed to become eligible for continuing care and how well we are implementing their rights and their eligibility for continuing care. I'd be glad to send that to the committee when that is published. Thank you.
I did want to ask you all about the National Care Service and whatever, but I really want to give more time to my colleagues in this session because we nearly run out of time in the last one. So I'm going to move on to the health and mortality of care experienced children and young people and the statistics and reasons behind what that is with Sue Webber. Sue.
Thank you, convener. And yes, we were both on the same breakout last night, so it was so, so insightful in terms of today's session. So this question is to yourself, Lucy, predominantly, if you can help with this. So what actions do you think could help to address the higher than average rates of prescriptions and hospitalisations for care experienced children and young people? And also, what actions could help reduce the number of care experienced children hospitalised due to injuries, drug poisoning and other external causes? So there's a lot in that, but it's all sort of similar and the same sort of theme to bring all together. Thanks, Lucy.
Yeah, of course, Sue, that's a really important question. And I just want to acknowledge in terms of health and mortality that as a membership organisation who holds relationships with many care experienced people of all ages, we have felt personally the impact of loss of people that have died far too young, who we work with and who we support. And I just want to take a moment to acknowledge that. In 2014, we began to create our own record of those people because we feel that, you know, their lives and the loss is not being recorded within the kind of death stats that we do have around care experienced young people. And I think that's just something to raise in terms of, I will get to sort of Sue's question on actions, but around the invisibility of some of these early deaths that we're seeing, is that sometimes these young people are, you know, leaving care before 16, so not being picked up in aftercare services. Sometimes these young people are, you know, off the radar of social work and others, but we know who they are because we hold those relationships. And that's more of a data question, which we can talk to in a bit more detail if the committee would like to. In terms of actions around creating better health and, you know, reducing health risks for care experienced children and young people, we need to acknowledge there is an inequality in terms of the experiences of health, which we're seeing for looked after children. And I think one of the things that we feel is really, really important is there needs to be a right to healthcare and mental health from the point that someone is looked after or coming into care. And I think especially around mental health, we need there to be a proactive approach in offering lots of different types of support from an early age and not waiting until crisis arises. I was tuned into the session earlier, and really it's echoing so much of what the general mental health community are saying, that we're having to wait until people are suicidal, at risk of taking their own life, you know, in order to have these interventions. And really from the earliest point possible, we should be offering all different types of support to young people. We know that care experienced people will have potentially greater needs in terms of their mental health, their well-being, some of those early experiences that Kate spoke to, complex trauma, difficulties with relationships. We need to have a proactive approach. And that's not just about referral to CAMHS and clinical models, but all sorts of different types of support for well-being and for health. Because really those hospitalizations, substance misuse, some of the points that Sue raised there as unaddressed needs from earlier in life, and also when problems are left without that kind of support and proactive questioning, curiosity and understanding of what does this young person need to thrive and have all of those needs met. So I think for us, the really big ask for the committee to consider and think about is how can we support the workforce, work alongside the promise, to make sure that from the earliest stage possible, children who are in care are having this proactive offer for support for their health and well-being across mental health, across physical health, and for any other health needs they might have, rather than waiting for that crisis point where hospitalisation might occur, whether that's, you know, later in life as an adult or while still actually looked after. So I hope that answers your question, Sue.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I think I might bring in Jackie Brock on this, and just maybe mention to our panellists that if, although our members are directing a question to a certain individual, if you have anything to add, I'll try and take you. If you just use the chat box and put an R, but can I come to Jackie on this?
Thank you. And really just to, again, to build on Lucy's points, the key, and I'm really interested in what she was talking about in relation to how the current legislation could be improved, which is something that we'd be really happy to look at how we can support that in terms of the some of the plans and giving a bit more detail in the next steps for the Promise Scotland, and obviously we'll build on your committee's recommendations, convener, as well. I think the key thing around what we can do, a contribution I hope by the Promise Scotland, is that we have brought together, and this will include Who Cares Scotland, a whole range of bodies looking at the data hand in hand with Celsus and others. And that's really focusing in on what matters to children and young people who with care experience. And it will be, I think, a really useful resource. And that's how we in the Promise are going to work with Scottish Government and others to measure progress. So much of what you're battling with, I think, in the committee is with waiting lists and referrals, etc. But what actually has mattered to children and young people and what's been effective, there's a huge gap in the available data, evidence and intelligence, convener, that we simply cannot achieve sustainable progress until we really get a grip on what data is important for us collectively in Scotland to measure based on what children and young people tell us about their experience. So we're in the Promise Scotland, we'll be publishing something on behalf of and with our partners in July that will give a central
database and proposal for how we can use the data based on what matters, because it is out there. It's just the pulling together and the mapping and the collection of it that we think will really help make and will really start to make progress to help link what we want to achieve in terms of our policy goals with knowing that that's having the right impact on individual children and young people. And I should just say that's also had significant support, this approach, from local authorities and other partners, for example, the Care Inspectorate, and also the workforce. For example, we work very closely with Unison as well. Hope that's helpful.
Thank you. Can I come to Helen Harper?
Yes, thank you. Just to make perhaps an obvious point, but our care population is not representative of the population just in general. We have a population of young people who find themselves in the care system who come from backgrounds of poverty and disadvantage. And we know that the health inequalities in Scotland are huge, and that where children are experiencing from an early age poverty and disadvantage, their health, not just their mental health, but their physical health is blighted. So there are some structural things that really need to happen in terms of addressing poverty and disadvantage for children and young people. We have large numbers of children, we shouldn't forget, who are looked after at home. They are still in the care system. They happen to be living with their families. They are struggling. Their families are often struggling to meet basic needs in terms of food and warmth and care. And we really need to be addressing those things, as well as looking at what's happening within the system itself. We need to be looking at addressing those health inequalities, which we know has an impact all the way through life. And that issue around, it's not just your childhood, it's then how that follows you into your adult life.
Yeah, thank you. And every single person that we've had in front of us in this inquiry has said that, Helen, so thank you. Ahead of moving on to the next theme with Stephanie Callaghan, I'll bring in Kate McKinnon, and I'll need to move on to the next theme.
Thank you. I'll be very brief. I completely agree with the points made by my colleague. There is, my colleagues, absolutely a need to improve how we collect data, to improve how we support people early, and how we address the wider health inequalities that also affect their experienced children. I would just add a few more points to those considerations, that some of what we know, for example, from the Care Inspectorate's periodic reports around this area, the recommendations from these really chime with what we already know about what we need to be doing to support children and young people. The continuity of relationships in their lives is so crucial, and looking at what structures and supports need to be in place across Scotland to ensure that we build and we enable stronger relationships matter to them. And for one other smaller example, the recommendations also mention earlier identification of risk, and we know that those assessments are really skilled assessments that are being done by practitioners who we need to continue supporting and ensure that, in addition to skills, they have the day-to-day support to make those risk assessments and work coaching to ensure that their well-being is looked after while they make those highly complicated assessments. And again, this chimes with the importance of relationships to make those complicated and complex assessments to support and protect children and young people. Having a strong relationship with them is so important. So I would just add those few other points, that much of what we know we need to do in terms of the particularities chime with other aspects of what we need to do. Thanks.
Thank you. So we want to ask you around sexual and reproductive health. Stephanie Callaghan, can you direct your question, please, Stephanie?
Thank you very much, convener, and thanks for coming along today, panel. My first question is, we nearly a quarter of girls in care getting pregnant, and care leavers at much higher risk of having their babies removed. I'm wondering, what steps do you think we can take to tackle the stigma, and also to help care experienced young people to plan for their future and to make confident decisions?
And who would you like to ask that for?
Looking at either Lucy or Jackie. Yeah, Lucy. Yeah. Thanks.
I'll bring in Lucy.
Thank you so much for that question, and also the evidence that we submitted from members. We've done quite a bit of work to explore the areas of sexual and reproductive health, and also recently have been doing some more focused work around care experience parenthood as well, and some of the challenges that you've spoken there around pregnancy and decision making. So really, in terms of what we found, you know, members have told us some quite clear messages about what would really help, and there's quite a few actions we can take to really improve how young people in care are supported to understand sexual health, to feel, you know, they have the autonomy and control of their own bodies and are making these decisions in a way that feels informed and safe. And I think one of the key messages for the committee is how we can support carers and families and those working with young people to feel more confident in this space. It is a really difficult area to get right in approaching these conversations. And again, as I was saying earlier with other health inequalities we were discussing, it's about a proactive approach that isn't disciplinary and punitive around, we know this is a risk, we're being risk averse, but actually a proactive, positive approach about, you know, carers feeling able to start these conversations and normalise talking about sexual health, normalise talking about the kind of the changes that people will be experiencing and thinking about as they go through their young lives. And I do think that you know, that's something we can really work on and hear from care experience people themselves. How would they want those conversations to be led out in their homes, wherever they're living, whichever care placement they may be in? And I think as well, we just really need to understand the right to inclusive education for all young people, and especially, you know, when people are moving placement, maybe those relationships are being disrupted. A lot of these conversations are based around trust, around honesty, and being able to know that you can share something that might be quite scary, that you're not sure about, an experience that you might have had, without feeling that you're going to get in trouble or there's going to be kind of a risk associated with you, rather than seeing actually there's a need there for some guidance, for information, and also just to be listened to in a judgment-free space. And I think the area around sexual health, you know, we have made so much progress with RSHP. We've got a new approach in schools from early years all the way up to, you know, secondary school now. And I think we need to bring that conversation into homes and into the way that carers care, you know, are giving their care to young people in the care system. So really my kind of call of what members have told us is they want there to be that confidence in carers and others being able to lead out these conversations proactively and creating a safe space for people to bring up any concerns they have. Because if we don't do that, you know, young people we know will turn to the internet, they will turn to friends and peers. There are many other ways that people access information about sexual health, and not always that information isn't always accurate, and also isn't about kind of having someone to discuss those decisions with and really work through some of the worries or fears or concerns that they might have as a young person trying to navigate these different issues. So I think, you know, we do often talk about young pregnancy and a risk-averse approach in terms of teen pregnancy, but I think where the conversation needs to shift is how can we support proactive conversations around sexual and reproductive health that feel supportive, and our rights space that's really about supporting young people to feel an ownership over their own bodies and their own choices that they're making around sexual and reproductive health. And again, we do have that report that we've submitted to the committee with our members' views on this, which has far more detail on the different topics that I've just been talking to there.
Stephanie?
That's great. Thanks very much for that, Lucy. Just to kind of follow on from that as well there, and I realise that probably you're talking about carers and families there getting the support they need from health and social care workers as well to do that really well. So I'm just wondering as well, on a wider, more general level around sexual health and reproduction, what training needs do you think exist in the health and social care workforce?
Is that directed to Lucy again? Yeah. Lucy?
Yes, it was. Sorry.
Thank you for that follow-up question. This is a really important point. And again, you know, obviously, I was talking a lot about the home environment, but we do know that sexual health services will be needed, and reproductive health services will be needed for many young people in care. So I think the key messages we're hearing is that we need trauma-informed practice across the whole of the NHS, across universal sexual health services. We have some amazing practice out there. You know, the NES training program, NHS Education Scotland program, but we need that to kind of be across the board. And I think part of what we're hearing is that, you know, young people interacting with these services need to be able to have choice about you know, gender professional, and there needs to be kind of more understanding of how it, being trauma informed, you know, it can be a bit of a buzzword. How can that really play into the practice of the NHS and the services that we are providing? And I think that not just choosing gender of doctor, but also just an awareness of what a history of sexual abuse may impact someone who's, you know, actually interacting with these services for the first time, and not assuming things about people's family background. I think one of the key things we have heard is that when care experienced people interact with universal services, there can be a lack of understanding of what care is, and the fact that people won't always have, you know, a solid family network to fall back on, that they can go and get support after an appointment, after a procedure. There needs to be a much kind of broader awareness of that. As corporate parents as well, you know, the NHS and health boards have a responsibility to be thinking about tailoring those services and understanding how do we identify the needs of care experienced people and how do we meet those in a trauma-informed way. So I think the key messages really are that there needs to be more awareness of what care experience might mean for someone, and also that trauma-informed does need to play out in practice across, you know, that first point of call in GPs, but also in specialist sexual and reproductive health services as well. So I hope that's helpful for answering your question.
That's really helpful. Thanks very much, Lucy.
Thank you. And Kate McKinnon wanted to come in on this as well.
Again, I'll be really brief. It's only to add on to the points of my colleague that when we're thinking about the importance of training and skilling the workforce, it's an additional note is that it's also important to ensure that there's the capacity built in the workforce. So my colleague's rightfully pointed out the importance of young people being able to the adult or practitioner that they feel that they're closest to and that they trust or they have a good relationship with. We really need to be ensuring that skills and support and the time in their day to have what is really going to be a one-off conversation, but an ongoing conversation, that the workforce is equipped to have those, has all those resources across the board. So including even in small ways, the receptionist at a GP office, that same trauma awareness from their teachers in schools or a youth worker. So it's just really important to also think about the capacity that people have when we're thinking about the importance of the trauma-informed workforce.
Yeah, and that's a very good point. We had an individual last night who pointed to the fact that receptionists should be trauma-informed as well. The gatekeepers to often get and speak to somebody as well. Can I come to Jackie Brock?
Thank you. Could I just add briefly to that, convener, linking Helen, linking Lucy's work, obviously Helen's as well, but with some evidence that you were given earlier in morning's earlier session around the 10 principles of intensive family support. So Ms. Gallagher's question about dealing with stigma. I think if we were to, we've got a great opportunity, convener and committee, to look at the commitment by the government in relation to whole family support. And there's a significant amount of money being put into this over the years. But if we were to apply the principles of family support and now the resources and apply those in a way that Lucy set out for us about how you work and support with families that are going to be made up of children, young people with care experience who are now having children as well. If we could apply those principles, then that really would be giving the best start in ways that Lucy described that is going to achieve their most the most effective outcomes for that family. And I think making sure that we don't continue to treat children and people with care experience as those isolated figures. You know, they are going to be forming families and heading up families, and they also deserve the support that is in place from health, social care, local authorities, etc., to be considered that, and making sure that the workforce is sufficiently trained to avoid stigma in ways that it is, as we've heard, many good practices. But that's the key, one of the key principles of intensive family support, that it's non-stigmatizing, it's underpinned by rights. So again, we've got a great framework in place to tackle some of those structural and systemic issues, and making sure that those with care experience are seen
as beneficiaries of the forthcoming resources that are available around whole family support, I think is critical. In fact, they should absolutely be prioritised and services planned and delivered and reshaped accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you. We must move on. With all these themes, they could be a theme in themselves and we could have 2 hours on each theme. Can I come to COVID-19 and the health harms associated with that and questions from Evelyn Tweed? If you direct your question, please, Evelyn.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. Yes, I think we could have a whole hour just on COVID-19, but generally, what impact do you feel that COVID-19 has had on children and young people's mental health? And I would like to direct that to Lucy Hughes, please.
Thank you. Lucy?
Thanks so much, Evelyn. That's a really important question. I think the first thing I would like to address is that although the pandemic has put a huge, huge strain on mental health and wellbeing of care experienced people of all ages, including children and young people, many of the issues that we have seen as an organisation through our independent advocacy, through the helpline that we set up during the pandemic, were there before. And I think, as someone in an earlier session described it, you know, inequality has been supercharged by the pandemic. And so I just want to kind of draw attention to that, that these a lot of the things that we're hearing are not new issues, but it has just been exacerbated by COVID. I think some of the key points that I'd like to raise from our evidence is that we really saw the impact. You know, during COVID, what did we all do? We all turned to our support networks, our families, loved ones in order to have support through what's been incredibly challenging for all of our mental health the last couple of years. And there was an assumption that people would have that support and that actually, you know, it was up to the individual to try and kind of support themselves through a lot of what was happening. But what we know from people that were calling our helpline, that were asking for support for a variety of different practical measures, financial impact a lot of the time, was that actually there was a real sense of social isolation and the lack of connectedness that has just been a theme through so many of the sessions and the evidence that you've heard of the committee. And that does have a significant impact on care experienced people who maybe don't have trusted relationships, have a support network. And particularly for us, you know, older care experienced people who I was referring to earlier, who've left care, maybe have, you know, no longer got support networks of carers or family, living by themselves a lot of the time as well. And really the pandemic isolated many, many individuals through the last couple of years. And for us, a huge part of our work is creating connection and belonging, you know, through programmes that we have, such as Communities That Care, through our participation work. And all of that face-to-face youth work and community development work has had to be paused for a long time. You know, we've been able to do some of it online, but as many people here can definitely kind of attest to, that's been really challenging. Digital exclusion and many other barriers have kind of been in the way of that work continuing. But I think, you know, the key message for us really is that a lot of the health and wellbeing impacts we've seen around loneliness, isolation, struggling to access services, they were there for the care experience community before the pandemic. It's just really brought it to light and actually made a lot of the rest of the population understand these issues for the first time. So I think, you know, we can actually see now that this is something that we need to have a lot more kind of conversation about. Why are we accepting that, you know, people who are older, who are care experienced, don't have access to the same mental health support, don't have kind of that support from statutory services in a specialist way? You know, they very much have to try and access universal services like the rest of us. And I think that's really not good enough. We are hearing that, you know, with COVID, if anything, it's kind of added fuel to our fire to really, really change that and make sure that we're working alongside the promise to address the needs of the community that exists now whilst doing that prevention work to stop, you know, future instances of care experienced people feeling unsupported with their health and wellbeing whilst they grow up as well. So I hope that answers some of it. It's such a huge question. If there's anything particularly you want to ask us about, please let me know.
Yeah, thank you. Evelyn, if you're okay, I'd like to move on to talking about resources and workforce with Gillian Mackay. Sorry to curtail your questioning, but I'm very conscious of the fact we've got other items on the agenda to get to. Gillian.
Thank you, convener. So I've heard from the social care sector that increasing workloads and reduced resources
have undermined their ability to build relationships with young people, families and carers they are working with and to take early intervention. How do you believe this has affected the well-being of care experienced young people? And could I put that to Lucy Hughes, please?
Yes, of course. Thank you. Thanks very much for the question there. Was that around the impact that COVID's had on the ability for services to respond to health and wellbeing needs?
Generally on sort of increasing workloads and things like that as well. Obviously, the pandemic's had had an effect on that, but also probably the number of young people needing support has impacted that too.
Thank you. Yeah, definitely an important question. I think what we did see with COVID was obviously so many people had to kind of be redeployed to deal with crisis. I think you've heard that from many in the sector and local authorities. And we did see a withdrawing of services for various reasons. Obviously, many people were having to deal with crisis situations, but it meant that some of the support that was existing for care experienced people was more difficult to access. And obviously that need was hugely exacerbated. Like I've said, you know, the existing needs that were already there for many care experienced people became much more difficult. You know, themes around loss and grief for bereavement. I know that's again something that's affected so many people across the pandemic, but these were also issues that care experienced people were, you know, already having to kind of address before the pandemic. And it just has really created even more challenge, bringing a lot of those maybe feelings that were below the surface to the fore. And again, through the helpline that we had, we very much heard about the real difficulties and just not having someone to connect with and talk to about the issues that people were experiencing. The average call time that we had was over an hour. And even if that call had initially been around financial support, actually, a lot of the time people just wanted someone to speak to and someone to connect with. And I think we can all relate to that in terms of how the pandemic has really made us feel less connected with one another. But also just to point to something that, you know, we did as an organisation to address what we were seeing as a huge unmet need in terms of mental health was a counselling referral service that we set up during the pandemic. And, you know, because of COVID, we realised that the waiting times were just going to get worse, basically, for a lot of these services, which were experiencing such a huge, huge need. And we helped hundreds of people access a counsellor of their choice. Sometimes waiting times as little as 24 hours from when they would call the service and, you know, explain what their needs were and then actually access a counsellor. Whereas, you know, many of the people that we spoke to through that counselling referral service were on waiting lists for 18 months, maybe 2 years. By the time they spoke to us. So there are different innovative approaches we can take to really kind of understanding there's a specific need out there for care experienced people of all ages. And actually we need to have something that is much quicker. It's not about, you know, as we've heard in earlier evidence sessions, just saying we're going to add you to the waiting list for CAMHS. There are other approaches that we can take. And we'd be really keen, we've got a report coming out about the impact of that counselling service, which we would love to share with the committee. And obviously with yourself, Gillian, if you're interested, if you'd like to learn more about that work.
That would be great.
I think it's probably a good idea to bring in Helen Harper as well from the perspective of talking about the workforce challenges. Helen, are you happy for me to do that?
Yes, certainly. Lucy made the point, and I think in answer to the last question, that a lot of these issues are exacerbated by COVID, but they're not new. And I think it's really important to say that the workforce in general for social care, let alone children's social work and social care and other services for children, was pretty critical before the pandemic. It's been impacted by the exit from the EU and also now by COVID. And so I think, you know, we are in a quite a difficult situation going forward in terms of workforce in general. The numbers of people needed are pretty mind-blowing, really, when we think around the expansion of the early years workforce and the need for better resourcing in terms of care for older people. It's all coming from the same pot of people, if you like. So, you know, it is a really quite a dire situation. When we're talking about the workforce, I think it's important for us to remember that foster carers and kinship carers and adoptive families are also part of that workforce, and they make that up, and that's they don't always feel that. That's really important. We've seen the number of foster carers decrease year on year since 2016. So we need to be thinking most broadly. I think the importance of a workforce that's harnessed around a common understanding of both what young people who find themselves in the care system are experiencing and have experienced, but also that kind of trauma-informed practice is really important. So in terms of supporting the workforce that we have, I think there is a lot of good ideas around about revisiting that common core of training and support. But I don't think we can get away from the fact that the numbers situation is very challenging, and we do need to think about how we support people in our workforce, how we attract more people into this line of work and make it feel that they are valued and that they are cared for and that they are well supported, because we know that a well-supported workforce is likely to deliver much, much better work and support young people and their families much more than if they feel that they're, you know, that they're at the bottom of the pile and that their conditions are poor, and also that they're not actually valued as contributors.
Thank you. As usual, time has whizzed past. We have to move on to our final theme with questions from Paul Kane. Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I essentially want to just cover the theme of transitions and really look at what does a good transition look like and how do we do more, I think, to achieve those good transitions. And so my first question is really, has the local implementation of policy on transitions resulted in improved transitions for care experienced young people, or have things not moved forward as much as we might hope? And I would like to direct that to Lucy first.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Paul. Thank you, convener. That's a very important question. I think, you know, we have, in the legislative sense, made a lot of progress. We've had aftercare rights being extended to 26. We've had the introduction of continuing care. But what we're not seeing is full practice and implementation of these really ambitious legal commitments. And I think we need to acknowledge that. And I'm not sure, in terms of the data, the most recent data around how many people are accessing those services, but I know that that does exist, and there is still a lot of unmet need there. I think, just going back to my earlier point, I think it's really important that we think about, you know, in terms of how we talk about transition, it's about lifelong support for care experienced people. You know, a really important quote that we had from one of the reports that we did was that, you know, being care experienced doesn't leave you and doesn't just go away after a few months of support in a transition. So let's say someone's having aftercare support for a few months and then that stops, you know, what happens next? And I think this is where potentially the National Care Service could have a real opportunity to link up how we view a social care service over lifetime, or how we view different support over lifetime for a care experienced person. Very much we are still stuck in the sense that a care experienced person is a child or a young person. We're a community organisation and we have many older members who have no ability to access support in a way that is based on the fact that they were looked after as a child at some point. And I think we have seen huge developments in that, in terms of the care experienced bursary having no cap on age. And there's so much we could bring in sort of health and mental health arena with that same lens and focus, that it's not about transitioning from one service to another. It's about continuity of support through lifetime. And that's something that especially our older members have really pushed us on, in terms of we need to get much, much louder in how we're talking about that. But in terms of transitions, I think where current thinking is at, it's based on how the system works, how we kind of have young people aging out of services. And then we're like, OK, what happens next? Where do they go? Many of those young people don't have anywhere to go. And we don't have that joined up approach between housing, between different support services out there. I would say in a lot of adult services, care experience is invisible. You know, people are presenting to lots of different services with no acknowledgement of the fact that they were care experienced or that they had experience in childhood of care. There isn't robust ways to understand that across homelessness, across unemployment and so many other kind of life outcomes that we look at. And I'd actually also bring it back to the point around poverty, which I know that this committee has talked about with many different witnesses, but we know that from the relationships that we hold across a long period of time with care experienced people, that that lack of support in terms of the transitions leads many to end up living in situations of poverty, continued inequality. And so even if there have been those interventions throughout childhood, they've come from a family of where there is disadvantage, they could actually end up back in that exact situation in their own adulthood. And as we were saying earlier, these are people who will go on to have their own families, who will have their own children, and also should have access to all the things that we want as adults to thrive and feel supported to live healthy lives, you know, throughout our lifetimes. So, you know, I've covered so many things there, but I think, you know, when we talk about transitions, it's very much thinking about the system as it already exists for care and protection. And I think we need a rethink about how we support people across lifetime with care experience.
Thank you, Lucy. Thank you for covering all those things, because we have just gone over time, and apologies to Paul, I can't come back to you because we've got two more items. I want to thank all our panellists again for the comprehensive evidence that they've given us, and just to say that, of course, if there's anything after today you think, I wish I'd mentioned this, I wish I'd flagged this up, please email the committee and we will take that into account. We will break for 5 minutes while we allow our witnesses to transfer over. Thank you.
Thank you. Our third item today is an evidence session on the Provisional Common Framework on Public Health Protection and Health Security. And I welcome to the committee Hamza Yousaf, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, who is joined by Erin McCready, Sexual Health and Bloodborne Virus and Infectious Disease Team Leader of the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, I guess I want to ask, obviously we've got the backdrop of the response to the pandemic, in which this common framework, of course, wasn't in place. And I think a lot of us, we really want to know whether or not this framework would have made any difference to the Scottish Government's ability to respond in the way that it did. And, you know, is there still room for a differentiated response in terms of public health threats by the Scottish Government in the future as a result of this common framework?
First of all, good morning, Convener, to you and all committee members, and hope you're all keeping safe and keeping well. You're straight in with the tough question, and I'm not surprised that you're asking. I think it's a key question. If I take the questions in the order that you asked them, I mean, it's difficult to answer, isn't it? You know, if the framework was in place at the outset, excuse me, of COVID, would it significantly change the response of the four nations? I suspect not, because the data sharing has been good. It always evolved, actually, as we have gone through the pandemic. But the data sharing with the UK government, certainly, I have to say, my time as Health Secretary, but I know I was in Cabinet, of course, in a different role at the beginning of this pandemic, the data sharing has been good. The collaboration on a four nations basis has been good in terms of a response to the pandemic. There are times where it's been of concern, and we've raised those and vocalised those and articulated those, sometimes in private, sometimes quite publicly, and that's well understood. But on the whole, I think that four nations collaboration on these matters and the sharing of information has been good. That being said, that doesn't mean that it will always be thus, and therefore for future, whether it's this pandemic, which has still got to run its course, or indeed for any, goodness forbid, future health public health threat, it's important to have this framework underpinning the principles of that collaboration. The second part of your question, I think, is equally an important one. And again, let me just stress that the framework, while it has those overarching principles, it doesn't stop any of the four nations acting in a differentiated way if it wishes. So there's nothing in this framework. This framework, in essence, is policy neutral. So it doesn't stop the Scottish Government, Welsh Government, Northern Irish, or indeed, of course, the UK Government taking decisions that are divergent to other home nations.
That's very helpful. Thanks for outlining that. I'm going to move on to questions from Gillian Mackay on the role of Parliament and indeed this committee. Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, will implementation of the framework impact on parliamentary scrutiny and decision making in this policy area? And if so, what impact do you think it will have?
Well, I certainly expect the Parliament would have no less of a role than it did in the previous system, and absolutely open, I should say, from a Scottish Government perspective, that where possible, if that role could be enhanced. I suspect probably this will only become clear or more clear as the framework actually becomes embedded in our public health infrastructure. But for example, there is a review period that's built into the framework, and maybe that provides quite a good opportunity or quite a good hook for Parliament to consider its operation and whether it's delivering as well as we'd hope it would. So, you know, these are ultimately questions for Parliament to answer, I should say, as opposed to government. But if Parliament wanted further scrutiny, and thought that review point was the correct point by which to invite myself as Health Secretary and my officials wanted to undertake a more detailed review themselves, this committee perhaps, or indeed scrutinise, for example, work plans. I'm really open, I have to say, to any role that Parliament wishes to have in this, because it's such an important agenda and issue.
Thank you. That's everything for me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. In terms of international relations, we've got questions from Paul O'Kane. Paul?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. My kind of first question in this area is the Scottish Government comfortable that the common framework will provide sufficient opportunity for it to provide input to any future negotiations, or indeed, I think, for fulfilment of international obligations in the area? So I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would comment on that.
I suppose for international obligations and any future negotiations in relation to that, this framework doesn't really alter the devolved settlement, but doesn't alter it at all, actually, the devolved settlement. So I think that's probably important. So Paul Kane and I will probably have slightly different views in relation to whether or not Scotland should have more of a role, or indeed its own role, in relation to international treaties, international engagements, international obligations, I should say. But notwithstanding those differences, if we park those for a minute, it doesn't alter the devolved settlement. So, you know, the UK's fulfilment of international obligations are largely, not exclusively, entirely, but largely reserve matters. So where we have a legitimate devolved interest in reserve matters, then I do believe the framework provides us with that useful set of tools that gives us the greatest chance of influencing negotiations. And the process thus far in terms of the framework has been really engaging. And when it's come to engagement with the EU in terms of the MOU that the UK has signed with the EU in relation to for example, the ECDC, Scotland has had the ability to represent that. So that's positive. But of course, ultimately, you know, if I can't promise you that there will always be alignment between what the Scottish Government, or indeed even the Scottish Parliament, wants in relation to international obligations and what the UK Government would end up doing. Ultimately, the framework doesn't alter that significantly.
Paul?
Thank you. I mean, I suppose following on from that, and I know that I've asked the Cabinet Secretary about this before in other areas of this work, but essentially dispute resolution, when there is a kind of difference of opinion, and I know he will use his good nature and strong relationships to try and find that way through in terms of Scottish Parliament's position or indeed Scotland's position on an issue. But is it his view that, you know, there's a robust resolution procedure that we would be able to use, and would that be invoked more readily, or does he have concerns? I'm sure he does, about unilateral decision making. You know, does he have a confidence that there is that procedure in place?
Yeah. So look, Paul Kim will know that, you know, if there's a chance for me to you know, put on record my concern about the approach the UK government is taking, I won't be shy in doing so. I'll do that regularly, and I'll do that rightly. That's my job, is to stand up for the interest of the people of Scotland. I should say equally, where things are working well, I'm not shy or reticent to say they're working really well. And the process of the common framework, I think, has been really good, collaboration. And therefore, I wouldn't envisage in this particular area of the common framework and what it looks to address that we would get to that stage of dispute resolution. Certainly not the evidence I've seen thus far. But of course, this is about the future too. So yes, ultimately, if we couldn't get that agreement, if every other lever that we tried through informal discussion with the UK government, official level discussion, ministerial level discussion, correspondence, etc., if all of that didn't work, then of course that that dispute resolution mechanism exists there for good reason. But I should say, on the evidence thus far, you know, I wouldn't see that needing to be invoked, certainly not in the in the short or medium term.
Thank you, Paul. Can I move on? Thank you. In terms of information sharing, we've got questions from Sue Webber. Sue.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for coming along today, albeit virtual. So we hear at length from everyone about how much pressure everyone's workloads are under. So I'm hoping that you might be able to help, that you get a sense that this framework will reduce duplication in the likes of the scientific advisory and expert groups that we have across the four nations. And are there plans, any plans to develop greater consistency in the way the data is collected, analysed and presented across the United Kingdom?
I think that's a really good question. And you know, in time, it might well do that in terms of reduction of duplication. But what I would say is that it is also important, and I think whoever would ultimately agree with this, that it is important for each of the governments across the UK nations to have bespoke advice, because although there will absolutely be some common themes that affect Scotland, England, Northern Ireland and Wales, there's also distinct you know, issues that affect us uniquely, and therefore having that scientific advisory group for the Scottish Government is really, really important for us, given again the unique pressures that we might face that might be different to parts of England, parts of Wales. And indeed, Northern Ireland perhaps is the most obvious example, where they're sharing that land border with a member of the European Union. So yes, absolutely, to reducing duplication, for sure. Again, I think that probably will happen more as we see the framework embed, but look, I would always reserve the right for us to make sure we have that bespoke advice coming to us where appropriate.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. And can I come to Emma Harper on questions around cross-border cooperation? Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'm just interested in whether the Cabinet Secretary has any concerns about cross-border cooperation with the EU, specifically in that in our papers it says that access to the early warning and response system is by ad hoc method, which pretty much means that if there is a potential health issue, then it will be up to the United Kingdom to basically write to the EU and ask if the UK can be part of this ad hoc process.
Yeah. Look at. In short, I won't, you know, labour the point. I think everybody here would understand that the Scottish Government obviously would have far preferred that we retained our EU membership. You know, that would have given us greater access and be part of, you know, ECDC, for example, and of course wouldn't have to have MOUs, which although they can be they're positive, they're suboptimal to actually EU membership. But you know, again, in one sense, there's no point in labouring that point. But I think it is important to put on record that, you know, any arrangements that we put in place in terms of cross-border cooperation with the EU are now suboptimal in comparison to EU membership. In terms of cooperation, you know, we would expect there to be a strong system of intelligence and data sharing, and the UK, of course, as we know, has entered into an MOU, the UK Health and Security Agency, I should say, with the European Centre for Disease Control. We're pleased to see the MOU has been signed, but frankly, I'm not convinced it will give us the parity of access that we had previously. In fact, we won't have the parity of access that we have previously. In terms of the Scottish Government's involvement, which is a really important point that Emma Harper asks around, again, if I was to go by the process of the framework, I would definitely be encouraged. Certainly, there was a role for Scottish representatives to be able to influence those discussions with the European Union. But ultimately, if we were ignored, then there wouldn't necessarily be recourse for us that would be adequate to ensure that our outcomes were and our desires in relation to that cross-border cooperation was satisfactorily being met.
Can I just, I guess, I suppose, touch on that as well? So if we're talking about cross-border cooperation with the EU, but as well as that, there's the cross-border cooperation with our neighbours south of the border. And I'm thinking about other, like the zoonotic diseases of SARS, MERS, swine flu, avian influenza, even Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease in the past. So we need to make sure that all the scientists are working together. So will the framework improve cooperation within the UK to make sure that everybody is sharing their scientific knowledge, so that we are better prepared if there were any future pandemics that we needed to be worried about?
Yeah, I mean, I think, well, but ultimately what it will ensure is that we don't have any less cooperation. So the danger obviously was with the exit from the EU, whereby we were duty-bound to have that cooperation with the exit of the EU, that we didn't lose that cooperation, and therefore the framework ensures that we don't have any less cooperation, which is important. I think for the purposes of looking forward, the framework and accompanying MOU that sit alongside it, I think absolutely ensures that there'll be good collaboration within the UK, but also with our European Union partners, which is important. In terms of the framework, members will be aware, I'm sure it's probably in your briefing, there is the oversight group that is going to be really, really important. And of course, Scotland will have representation on that in order to ensure that cooperation is being maximised wherever possible. So, I think the framework will evolve as it embeds. But I have to say, for me, the early signs are certainly encouraging.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. And finally, can I come to David Torrance, who has some questions around resources. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, will there be any plans to increase the health protection resources in Scotland, where it has been identified as a need in the areas of review of disease notification, analysis of Four Nations working groups, and the evolving science of genomics?
The framework was developed not to necessarily impose or incur costs on any of the governments that were taking the lead in certain areas. That's not to say we wouldn't bolster resources. I think we would, particularly in the area of genomics. I mean, my goodness, the pandemic's taught us a lot, but it's clearly taught us the importance of genomic sequencing. We have committed as a government, in fact, and the First Minister referenced this on a number of occasions, have put on record our desire to further increase our resources around genomics. So while the framework doesn't necessarily do that, those areas where we lead, I think naturally we would want to make sure that they're well resourced.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, David. And Sandesh Gohani would like to follow up with a question. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The common framework, it's good to hear what you're saying, the positives of this common framework. I'd just like to ask, does this also mean that we'd have increased sharing or in other areas of health research?
So the framework itself might not go into detail of that, but I think it's vitally important where we can share further research, intelligence. It just helps to build up our knowledge, particularly of the pandemic. That's the current issue that we're dealing with and facing. And research studies from across the UK have helped to inform our thinking and our decision making. And look, I think we should look to do that. I mean, just Dr. Kohani and I will have very different opinions on the constitutional future of Scotland. That's fine. I think ultimately, whether we're independent, whether we're part of the union, sharing of that information across borders, both on these islands but also with the European Union, is hugely beneficial. I wouldn't want to lose that, regardless of what our constitutional devolution setup is in Scotland at the time. So yes, is the answer to your question in terms of ensuring that we continue to share. The framework might not, determine all of that, but certainly I know from my discussions with the UK government, they are in the same place that I am, and I know my Welsh and Northern Irish counterparts are, that the more we can share that research on health, the better to all of our citizens.
Thank you. So thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for giving us that feedback on our questions today, and to his officials for joining us this morning. We are going to move on to our next item on the agenda now, colleagues, which is the fourth item on our agenda, and that is consideration of a notification from the Scottish Ministers for consent to the following instrument: European Qualifications, Health and Social Care Professions Amendment, EU Exit Regulations 2022. And the purpose of this is to correct errors within the European Qualifications, Health and Social Care Professions Amendment, EU Exit Regulations 2019, and correct an error created by these regulations in the National Health Service Performers List England Regulations 2013. So under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, this consent notification has been categorised as Type 1, and that means that the Scottish Parliament's agreement is sought before the Scottish Government gives consent to the UK Government making secondary legislation in devolved competence. Do any members have any comments on the consent notifications? I see that Sandesh Gohani does. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. I want to put on to record the fact that I'm against the idea of having a performance list. I think it's outdated and something that we would be able to get rid of, not only across the UK, but in Scotland. And as far as this particular motion is concerned, I think it's something that probably does. It's just a correction. But I do want to put onto record that I'm against the performance list.
Okay, and that's at UK level, so that's that you've put it on record. That's something you may want to flag up to our parliamentary colleagues in the UK Parliament. Emma? Emma Harper.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just think that, you know, in reading our papers, we just need to be very aware that when legislation is changed in England, and that impacts or could impact our healthcare system in Scotland, we do need to make sure that the Cabinet Secretary and that it keeps us informed, and we make sure that we do have an opportunity to pay attention to what has been taken forward, because some of this is, especially in a remote working environment, it is really difficult sometimes to, you know, pick up non-verbals, look at what we need to do, find the right questions, and make sure that the committee is kept completely informed about this kind of issue as we go forward.
And do any other members have any comments they'd like to make before I put the next question to you? I'm not seeing anyone does. Ask the question then, if the committee is content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UKSI. I'm not hearing anyone saying they shouldn't, but I take on board the comments made by Sandesh Gulhani and Emma Harper. Is there anything else? Are we content that it be included in the UKSI? If you could just indicate to me by a nod or a shake of the head. We're all nodding. Are we all nodding? Yes, we are. Sorry, I'm just looking at some members just to make sure that I've got their consent. And is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a letter to the Scottish Government informing them of our decision today? Yeah, I'm seeing that. I wouldn't ordinarily ask for the robust shake of the head, but as Emma just mentioned, non-verbal cues are not very possible on this kind of platform. Thank you very much, colleagues. You have all given me your consent to do that. And the fifth item on our agenda is consideration of a negative instrument, and that is the Food Withdrawal of Recognition Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2021. This instrument removes exemptions for certain products in a number of regulations to help ensure that imported products meet compositional rules for food in Scotland and ensure Scottish business can maintain access to unfortified flour. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has considered this instrument and have made no recommendations to us, and no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any of our members have any comments on this instrument? You do not. Thank you. I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with that? Do not disagree with that. Thank you very much. So we are in agreement on this negative instrument. At our next meeting on the 25th of January, the committee will take more evidence from stakeholders and part of our inquiry into health and wellbeing of children and young people, and will also take evidence on the National Planning Framework 4. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you, colleagues.